Hello everyone, and how's it going? Today is the, I guess, the first episode, official episode of the Shiney and Glib show with me,
actually,
Shiney,
it's the 0th episode.
How does that even work? How do you have a 0 episode?
It doesn't work, but that's what we're here to find out.
It doesn't make any sense.
We're not sure if this makes any sense yet, but we're damn well gonna try and make it make sense.
So this is going to be a show which is going to be different to how we've covered Morning Nonsense or, let's say, the Smudcast. It's, well, Glib, do you want to explain it?
Yes, this is the Shiney Show starring me, Glib, the only podcast. Oh, wait, that's the wrong podcast. That's Emperor Lemon. No, we just want to talk about film stuff that isn't involving the same old shit that you've seen a million times, which is, did you hear what Amber Heard did to Johnny Depp's bed or... I heard that they're hiring a black man to play a white man or whatever.
Did you hear that really Lucasfilm has said another thing which has outraged fans? They've retconned everything.
Kathleen might leave the company after she retires with an excellent package. And
because she's your audio is coming famous producers a bit quiet, in Hollywood.
What'd you say?
Your audio is a bit quiet.
Alrighty then.
Anyway, we're going to avoid all that. We're going to avoid...
No matter where I go, my audio is a different level. If it's on Literature Devil's show, it's a different level. If it's on Smud's Discord, he has me juiced up or something. I can never get an even fair thing. Is it?
That's
hear me
just
now?
Life, though.
You can hear me now?
Yes, you're fine.
Is it still quiet, or am I...
You're fine now.
Through? Okay. Alrighty, then.
So, today we're going to be covering the... Oh, I believe you wanted to cover the Star Trek
options.
Writer's Guide.
We didn't really plan this out, and I kind of intended it to be like that. I wanted to see what actually would happen. So I want to do the writer's guide, yeah, and then also if we have backup stuff. Shiney and I were just watching tests yesterday to see what we could get away with copyright wise, and a lot of the behind the scenes stuff that I want to watch actually we could probably get away with, and then copyright claims would be audio or something later, which I'm not really concerned about. I just want to talk about stuff and watch it, and then. Afterwards.
Well, it's not the first time we've watched behind-the-scenes stuff on my channel. We watched some of the behind-the-scenes of the Clone Wars.
Well, that's the good stuff. That's what I want to watch. So if we run out of steam on the Star Trek Writer's Guide, which I wanted to cover because the idea of having a Bible that you could work from and how strict the rules were at the time, I think is pretty telling. So if that doesn't... cover it. I have a couple other things I'm interested in. I want to watch the Back to the Future stuff, if possible, or we can watch the making of the Empire of Dreams thing with Star Wars, which is always interesting to talk about because in that we can look at the miniature stuff, we can look at the effects, we can talk about whatever we want. Because I'm not exactly sure what you're interested in talking about. I know that I'm, you know, I want to direct, I want to write, I want to be at the center of everything when it comes to creating content. So I'm interested in every aspect of it. I don't know how you feel about that. What do you think?
Well, I'm interested in every aspect of the film as well. Okay. Then my main knowledge tends to lie in the technical aspects of visual effects, like the CG and the 3D elements. But I obviously I can talk about storytelling.
My main knowledge
I've been doing it for like how many years now?
It's not being prepared for the show. But speaking of, if you want to get started and crack open that, we can do that. Or we can start with something that has to do with like Roddenberry talking about stuff. But I don't know.
I think Roddenberry talking about stuff would actually be interesting to start with.
Okay, let me go and grab that.
There are so many great clips of Gene Roddenberry talking about Star Trek.
Yeah, that's
I especially love some of the behind the scenes clips where he berates people for not understanding how the show works, like when he schooled people about the deflectors.
Oh, well that was did you watch Chaos on the Bridge with Shatner? It's kind of a shame that we can't show that.
No, I don't think I have. I've mostly just seen snippets.
Shit. I really wish we could watch that, but they go into how he was pretty on the Next Generation. He was kind of old already, but he was still holding people to this standard. And a lot of writers were quitting because he was rewriting scripts and because he was rejecting things that were inconsistent with something that he had accepted the week before that. So it's just interesting to me that like it's a guy that's very strict about his vision, And at the same time, he's creative in that he just wants it to be egotistically centered through himself. You know what I mean? He wants to be able to create content in a certain way, but if the rules don't follow through, then it's not going to work for him. Even though, objectively, something might actually be really good. Somebody might write an excellent script. He might take it apart because he wants to turn it into his thing. And so Star Trek, I think he thought was his thing. And one of the things that was interesting at the time when they were creating Next Generation out of what was supposed to be the next phase and the movies was that he was really bummed out that he didn't have a direct say in the movies. So when TNG came out, he really wanted to be in charge of it. And I'm still trying to formulate my idea around if he got what he wanted or what we got, which wasn't exactly what he wanted, was better. And that's kind of what I wanted to talk about, is that you can have a plan, you can have a writer's guide, and you can have very strict standards, but you can still stifle your own creativity by being too much in control of that. So I don't know if you want to pull that up and we can.
Well, yeah, I've got it here ready to play.
Gene Roddenberry is the creator and producer of Star Trek. I met with this thoughtful, friendly man in his office at Paramount Studios. He had a lot to say about what we see on our television screens today, and of course Star Trek. Although the show was his idea, the network at first had ideas of its own.
If there is a truism in television, it is that no successful show ever gave a network exactly what it wanted. But that isn't because the networks are dopes or dunderheads. It's because of the different way an artist looks at things and the different way business people look at things. And that's as it should be. I'm sure Michelangelo had the same problem when he was doing his beautiful things.
What about the cast of the show? I'm told that NBC...
Very quickly, I think that's a very big truth with TV. It's like there's always the creative idea, and then there's the what's great for creativity and what's great for business.
Well, those, like those say, people what's... Yeah, go on. Sorry, I interrupted you.
I was going to say, what's often great on the business side is, okay, we're going to make a sequel. We're going to make a remake. We're going to make a prequel and all this, that, and the other. And that's what often fuels a lot of these endeavors, even though they don't creatively make sense.
Yes, sorry. I just wanted to say Avery. No, not to Avery. Who said that? We didn't cut Literature Devil out. We actually asked him, but he's burnt out today. Sunday is absolutely his rest day after doing six days straight. We sent out an open invitation to any of the crew that wants to come on. They can come on. You know what I mean?
Glib, also, Voice, Smud, Lit Dev, they're all free to pop on whenever they want.
Yeah, they can come in. Yeah. So anyway, the thing that I was thinking was that when you're producing a show, it's like your ass is on the line. You're the guy that has to bring in the money, plus it's your reputation. What's going to show up on the next thing that you're going to do? There's a lot of, you know, how many failures can somebody take in Hollywood, and how many failures do they think that they can handle? That's a very interesting thing, because we're used to people failing upwards, right? We're used to seeing that as a paradigm, but that wasn't always the case. That's sort of a more nepotistic, friend-based Hollywood, you know what I mean? And at the same time, if you do fail, and let's say it's not even like your fault or something like that, that means that you want another chance, and somebody should give you another chance. It's a very fine line. So when a producer gets something put across their desk, they have to be able to discern something in relation to the previous. They have to say, oh, what have I seen before that's like this? So a lot of the time I hear that you should describe things like that. Oh, this is Titanic, but on a spaceship. You know what I mean? This is like Groundhog Day, but it takes place in an alien world where the guy landed on the alien world and now he has to survive. Like, and there's nothing wrong with putting those ideas out there, because when you're selling a product, I really think that the mystification of the product on top of the demystification is what you're selling. So it's like, here's a car. It gets you where you need to go. Yeah, but that's not what we're selling. We're selling a Mercedes-Benz. We're selling a race car. You know, we're selling the most comfortable car, or the car that'll keep your family safe. It's always something extra other than what the thing is. So what's the catch? Well, Star Trek to me is interesting, because you have this writer's guide, and I'm wondering if the writer's guide was ever put in front of a producer, right? Like, did they give that to the people that were the money people, or did somebody hear the script idea and go, yeah, that seems like a fun space adventure? Like, I'm very curious how the original Star Trek series was pitched, And then when it came around to TNG, it's like, oh, obviously we need Gene Roddenberry. I mean, he made all this money in spirit through the movies, and the show was a huge success in the minds of the people. We all know why that is. It's because he gives everybody this comfortable environment for science fiction stories to take place in, a place that you'd want to be at with food replicators and all this stuff. So how did he sell the original one? Well, he said it was a wagon. It was wagon to the stars or something. Wagon, you know what I mean? So he sold it as like a frontier show, which apparently was really popular at the time. And they didn't like the original iteration of it. So they made him reshoot the pilot. And then I think that the show that they actually went with on the first one was the one where the creature on that looks like every woman that you want it to be, absorbing the salt, the man trap. And then they turned the cage into the menagerie. And I always thought, personally, this isn't really quite related, but I always thought that it was a sign that Star Trek was really well made, where they could take their old pilot and refresh it and make a better episode out of it with their new characters. I thought that was incredible for the 60s. Without digital technology or anything, they literally just wrote a story out of the hour-long special that they had, right? So when it comes to Gene Roddenberry bringing it back all around, what I think we're actually talking about is we're talking about the difference between creativity and monetary motivation. It's a fine line when you're expressing what you were trying to represent, but it's not a fine line when you're actually producing it, because you have to take into consideration what's going to be monetarily successful and viable. And I think The Next Generation and then Deep Space Nine tell that tale, because as we were checking out some of the features from Deep Space Nine, the crew is very keen on explaining how DS9 was able to do what TNG wasn't, because they weren't following Roddenberry's direct guide. That was the first show, really, that he wasn't involved in, that after his death and afterwards. That DS9 was the Star Trek that the writers wanted to make. It was the dynamics that they wanted to put in there. And I think that there is an element that's really interesting where we have the original series and they have a certain set of rules, and we have TNG and we have a certain set of rules, and then DS9 is so interested in breaking those rules. So you have all these options for you to watch, and I think it's very interesting. You can definitely pick up anywhere along the timeline and find your favorite, but when you watch it from beginning to where it went, you can absolutely see how this writer's guide informed and created the show, was dropped a little bit so that it could be expanded on, and then the show fell apart because it wasn't following it at all anymore, really. Like, I don't think that Enterprise, and certainly not Discovery, did a very good job of following what Roddenberry's vision was. In fact, I'd say that if we ever talk about Enterprise, I have a lot to say on how them trying to make it like a popular show at the time is the thing that destroyed the show as a Star Trek show. So anyway, I just think that it's interesting that Roddenberry definitely had it out against the producers that were the nuts and bolts guys, because he just wanted to get his fantasy on the screen and, you know, fuck the costs. But isn't that every creative person? They don't really want to be constrained by the physics of reality and the money, and that's what producers do. They are the people that take your vision and your idea and actually go, okay, but how can we really do that? We can't afford that. How do we do this? And then that's how it becomes something else. And that's the collaborative process and the creative effort that I think a lot of people don't spend a lot of time thinking about. But I think that's what we're here to do, right? Think about that process. Yep. That's like, I think that would be the greatest way to describe this show, is the middle section in between the creative magical moment of coming up with an idea and then the final product. Like, there's so much gray area in between there, and so much stress, as we experienced by not really having the show set up.
The only thing I have to answer that, we'll just continue.
Only wanted white males on the bridge, no women, no blacks.
When I brought in a mixed racial crew, both the network and Desilu Studios, which had it at that time, came in saying, what are you doing? You're going to... And then when I insisted on
I didn't see that. What do you say? Did it skip?
White males on the bridge.
No.
About the cast of the show? I'm told that NBC only wanted white males on the bridge. No women, no blacks.
when I brought in a mixed racial crew, both the network and Desilu Studios, which had it at that time, came in saying, what are you doing? You're going to ruin us.
You're going
to
ruin us.
And then when I insisted on it, then the
I think it's funny that they're like, what are you doing? You're going to ruin us if you have this all-white crew. And now we live in the exact opposite.
He's saying that you're going to ruin us if you don't have this all-white crew.
Right, right. That's what I'm saying. And now we have the opposite. But he was right then. You know what I'm saying? Like, his thing was, I want to have all these different people on board. I want it to represent humanity. And that's why people think that Star Trek is woke or whatever. But I just think that that's well-rounded television. You know what I'm saying? And so what I think is interesting is that the studio's mandate about whatever's socially acceptable at the time is kind of irrelevant to the product that the creative person's making. They're just trying not to get canceled or fired or whatever for making a creative decision. And I think that that's the worst kind of executive oversight, is when somebody says to you, oh, you can't do that because people might get pissed off about it. It's like, yeah, people might get pissed off about any creative thing that we do. If we kill off a dog, they're going to be upset. What do you want? Do you want to not be creative? Do you not want to have the person create the vision that they want?
And ultimately, I know we're going to talk about politics, but I guess it's relevant here. We're going to keep it within the frame of media. But right, there's a different way in how characters, there's no inherent issue with having women or minorities in a media at all. But
wouldn't you have an issue if they weren't in Star Trek? If it was just like a bunch of white people? Wouldn't that make it less timeless?
I think it would remove part of the magic, yeah. But inherently, if you kept all the characters the same but changed all their races to be like white humans, yeah, remove the magic, but the characterizations would be of it round about the same quality.
Okay.
But anyway, you look at back at Star Trek and how it used to be. It always used to be that you could write minority characters or female characters in the, like, you'd write them as characters, you'd write them as well-fleshed out humans. They were their own people, essentially. But when you look at more modernized progressive characters, they're not human. They lack so many characteristics. Their only defining characteristic is that they are this race or gender or sexuality, and there is nothing beyond that. And it's all politically motivated. In that, if you represent, for example, a woman in Star Wars, they have to be amazing, or they have to be, they can't be seen as weak, and they have to be powerful. And this is a limitation, this is a problem which didn't exist back when Gene Roddenberry was making Star Trek. And while on the surface you can see similarities between trying to put forward minorities in old Star Trek and trying to put forward minorities in the modern day, they are two completely separate ways. Even though it's the same basic idea, the execution of these ideas are completely separate. One is like a great way to make media by writing these characters as human. The other way is completely horrific and ends up creating such shallow things. They're not even people, because they don't have anything defining. They're just a walking character trait. Not even a character trait, a walking skin color or a walking gender.
Well, it's interesting to me that Desi Arnaz was in charge of Desilu. So, you have this Cuban guy whose staff is saying, you need a wider cast to sell to the audience. I think that the audience is savvier, and I'm one of the things that I'm grateful about. This doesn't have anything to do with politics, really. It has to do with technology. Is that I'm glad that broadcasting is more available to more people now, and with that has come an interesting, let's shill for China or something because they have the biggest audience. But I think that creative people and I think that the grand producer types, they understand that. If you just make it's, what is it? Field of dreams. If you build it, they'll come. If you make the content and it's good, people will watch it. It doesn't matter where it's coming from. That's what anime is proving to us right now, I think. But as for the diversity thing, I love that Star Trek is diverse. I love that Star Trek, it takes place in the future. I like that element. Everybody's over everything that Gene Roddenberry was probably pissed about hearing every day in the 60s. Kind of like how I am. Like, if I was to design a sci-fi series, I'd be like, forget all of today's issues. Let's go back to ethical dilemmas and moral quandaries, because that's what's interesting to people. You know, forget like, does anybody want to watch a sci-fi story where the idea is that miscegenation is bad, and so you can't, you know what I mean? It's an anti-love story. It's like, we have to convince Gary not to have sex with this black woman. It's like, no, nobody wants to do that. You know what I mean? We want to see an ethical dilemma that has to do with issues of choice, not things that have to do with like issues of I love this person, but the society says I can't marry them, unless it's something hilarious, like I'm marrying this toaster, and that's what this comedic drama movie is about. Do you get what I'm saying here? Am I speaking to the void? Okay, cool. I think you understand what I'm saying. I'm glad that
very
Star
quickly
Trek advanced in
the sorry to interrupt rest. You, but we have two super chats. One from Mexican Iron Man, who donated $10. Hail from your new buddy. I've super enjoyed getting caught up on your great videos. From Mike, aka Mexican Iron Man. Thank you very much,
hey,
Mexican
that's
Iron
cool.
Man.
I recognize that because he's from the card thing, right?
Yeah, me and him were competing against each other to try and get the best, the best, for the trading card from, was it Fandom Collective?
Yeah, you guys, you are very good at making friends and meeting people, and you're the mediator. I like that. That's
well, cool. YouTube so is about the connection game, and it's
you're
good that
I'm
I can make...
Just, I'm antisocial, I don't want to talk to you.
I'm antisocial as well, but I just know that it's... a kind of reality that you do need to outreach to people, and it's extremely useful because you get invited onto live streams or you people share your videos, and it's a great way to get yourself out there. But if I didn't do that, then I wouldn't be where I am today, because I wouldn't have met Smud or Lit Dev, because I reached out for those interviews. Or in fact, I wouldn't even be at 1,000 subscribers, because what my connection with Geeks and Gamers was what led them to, Jeremy, to share my video on Friday Night Tights.
There you go.
I believe it was I'm trying to remember which one it was. The Mandalorian armor problem, that video.
All right. Well, I want to finish this Roddenberry thing, if you want to.
And very quickly, for another super chat from Dominic the Donkey, donated $40. Hello, lads. I hope you two are having a great day. Yeah, I'm having a great day, despite the fucking birds out my window. But
I sent my birds to go annoy Shiney, so my day's going great.
It's annoying because it's a hot day, and the only way to ventilate my room is to open up my windows, which obviously means birds.
I don't think anybody minds. I don't care, certainly. I wish I had birds around me and a nice cool breeze.
The problem is I still don't get a cool breeze. It's just birds. That's the only thing.
And then just imagining somebody goes, it's nice and windy outside, and you just open the window and just birds come flying in. Like, that's not what I wanted. Anyway, thank you for the super chats, gentlemen and ladies and monsters
and
far reaches of the galaxy.
Well, the super chats from this stream are being separated between me and Glib.
Yeah, something. We're both taking a cut here so that we can both benefit and have that drive, and it's all
it's only fair.
Equal. Yeah. So we appreciate it, and that'll actually help motivate us to do more shows. You know what I mean? That's the part of the reason why I didn't want to take monetization and a lot of things for a while. I was just like, it's going to affect my brain's processing. But if we can get this show going, I think it could get very interesting.
Agent Season said, if you show this black girl as an officer dealing with white people on that basis, you're going to be barraged with hate letters, and whole areas of the country are going to refuse to handle your show. And we often forget that's how the country was then. One thing that makes me love viewers and love the audience is that we never received in 20 years one single letter of that kind.
The pilot.
That's pretty
big. I think it is interesting that Roddenberry would, like, he creates this hopeful future, and he's actually incredibly optimistic about people, and he actually realized that people should be, like, fine with this.
I think he was totally exhausted with, like, all the stuff that he took issue with, so he just wanted to create this world where that wasn't the case. It's like everybody's equal, everybody's forward thinking, everybody, and especially next generation where everybody has like I hate to say it, but like next generation kind of has this older feel to it. Like everybody's middle aged and everybody's established that, like, you know, I've settled down a little. I'm gonna drink some tea and put on my comfort.
Well, I don't know if Picard seems middle aged. He seems more like he's in his 50s.
Yeah, exactly. He's like everybody's kind of they're not debonair. They're refined. What I really enjoy about Star Trek is that it gives this refined impression that you're putting out there a front of eloquence and elegance. Even when you're kind of a dirty man like Riker, he still has moral scruples. Even when he's just going on a rise and he wants to have sex with whores or whatever, different alien races, he's still kind of a noble guy. And I think that was what was what Gene admired so much about the subjects that he was admiring. I think, like, because he was never in the Navy, I don't think. He was never a military guy. And yet he still wanted to do a show about naval ships and that kind of thing, like Horatio Hornblower going out there and doing adventure stuff. So what's the purpose of that? What's the purpose of having science in the show? What's the purpose of having ethical quandaries? It's all of the optimistic future that you want to live in. And that's what I like about it being kind of like a noble, bright show in, as far as D&D alignment goes. Because there's you can throw a rock and find a grim, dark show anywhere. You know, you'll hit like five of them if you toss a rock. Like, The Expanse is going to give you that experience. You're going to get sort of a grittier look on something. Or Star Wars, where the action is more important than the issues at hand. Like, people aren't really going to talk in depth about, you know, my people and the prime directive in Star Wars. It's going to be like, you know, these people want to destroy us. We got to kill them. Let's go get them. So I think it fits this very interesting niche in the public consciousness where there's not really a lot of noble or positive science fiction out there that I can think of. And Star Trek filled that void. And it has everything to do with escapism to the future that is one that you want to be comfortable and live in. I think that if Star Trek felt like it was a 40K style universe where pain and death was around every corner, it wouldn't be interesting to people. I really think that the fantasy of it is what Gene and the fans share. I think that we all want to live in that world. And then it's about writing stories within that world, which is why I'm so focused on the Writer's Guide, because this show and its idea, its kernel of information, has created like literally 1,000 episodes at least. And I'm shocked anytime that I can think of like a franchise that has 1,000 episodes. Can you think of another franchise that has as many stories in it as Star Trek? I can't. Simpsons, maybe?
Stargate? It's got 10 seasons as well as 2 spin-off shows.
That's nowhere near as many, though. That's like maybe a third at most, right? 10 seasons compared to, what, 40 seasons combined of all the Star Trek shows? I'm not including Discovery and Beyond. I'm only including up to Voyager.
You've got...
plus the movies.
How many seasons did the original series get? 2? So that's 2 plus 7 plus 7 plus 7.
It was three original seasons, then 7, and then DS9 was 7, right?
Yeah. And then there's Voyager, so that's 14, 20, back maths, 21, and then that's Enterprise? 24. That's another
4,
yeah, so that's 28.
Plus the animated series, that's 3, right?
29.
The anime, something like that. And then, if you want, you can add in the movies, which are like an hour and a half each. And that I think that there's 13, maybe. So it's this really, really expansive thing. And all of those stories, even if they are overlapping and they have to be similar, they have to be unique, you know? So it's one of those things where it's like, I think that the core anchor, this writer's guide, this set of ideas that Gene put out there is the key. And that would be the same thing for any franchise. I think that's missing from a lot of franchises that weren't planned ahead of time like that. Like, how many Aliens movies can you make, or TV shows? Not that many. But that's because the idea is the disaster itself. You can do an Alien episode out of Star Trek, but that's because the show is built around the fantasy, not around the narrative. And that's something that I don't think I see a lot of. Like, he put world building ahead of storytelling to begin with. I think that it was probably a bigger burden for him to write the pilot episode of TNG with DC Fontana than it actually was to come up with the idea of it, if that makes
sense. To quickly build off that, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Something which I've noticed with a lot of very successful like franchises, for example, and one of the main like appeals of almost all of them is this extremely deep and expansive world that the writers has created. And it's often that the people like the world even more than the stories themselves. And I think Star Wars is sort of an example of this, as I've seen a lot of people who enjoy the world of Star Wars and that it's in even more than the original saga of, you know, the original trilogy.
Yeah.
And like you look at other things like Mass Effect. Mass Effect is only three games, but yet it's got this incredibly expansive world, which sells a huge appeal to people.
Do you think you could do a prequel of Mass Effect and it would work? Like just like being a Spectre agent or whatever they are and going
I think
around and solving issues?
Because there are so all the locations of Mass Effect and even all the races and everything, there are thousands of stories you can tell and have been told in other media like comics and such. Yeah, I definitely think you could tell like a detective story on the Citadel, or you could tell a story of almost anything in any location in Mass Effect. So yeah, you could definitely tell a prequel story.
It's such an
underused world, Mass Effect, where it's all these expansive and amazing ideas which are never fully built upon. The best you really get is a lot of the side missions, and obviously a lot of this world building is overshadowed by the threat of the Reapers, and that's what you have to deal with. And by the end of Mass Effect 3, it kind of shuts off any kind of idea of a sequel.
Right. So I have so many thoughts from based on what you just said. I have to like keep track of them. So when it comes to Mass Effect, do you think that the world building is connected intimately to the plot, or do you think that if you just removed the plot, let's say we were in the process of writing the original series and the Reapers didn't exist, you could go in a different direction?
You could, if you remove the Reapers, you could definitely tell a lot more stories in the Mass Effect world because it's that expansive.
Okay. What would you call the Reapers mechanically in the plot? Is it the plot? Is the overarching plot? Is the threat? It's a piece of the puzzle, right? So what I'm trying to say is how many pieces of the story do we take away until we're just left with the setup? What is the bare minimum before we start writing a story? Because that's what I think that this writer's guide is. I think that this writer's guide is just like, here is what my vision of the future is. And then you have to write into that. So I'm wondering if Mass Effect is like that, right? Because what we see a lot of, let me rephrase this. We don't see a lot of supplementary Mass Effect material other than the video games. But when we look at something like Star Wars, we see them attempting to just exploit it from every different direction. Give this character a story. Give this idea a story. Stealing.
Hey,
the
guy holding an ice cream maker in the background. He's got a fucking story now.
Exactly. But when we watch Star Wars, it's like there's not really... The world building is sort of like... remember in Rick and Morty where they're in the virtual world or whatever made by the Zygerian scammers? And when the thing freezes, they run off the edge of it? It's kind of like Star Wars. You're on a treadmill and the world is being built right in front of you. Like Lando. And then Leia goes, Lando's system. It's like, no, Lando's a person. In Cloud City, like before that moment, there was no Lando, there was no Cloud City, you know what I mean? But then when you have something like Star Trek, it's like the world is mapped out. It's like we have the shipyards on Mars and we have this space station and that kind of thing. And I don't know how often there's a moment in Star Trek where the plot is like how many unique, new, interesting races are created by plot elements as opposed to the world building defining it. Like, here's the neutral zone. So this episode is going to be about Romulans. Like, we can tell a story and then we already have pre-existing factions that we could use. Whereas something like Star Wars, I think you would need to create more. And I think that that's one of the primary problems with the sequel era is that their new creations, which is what George was depending on, like, here's the next thing, is not working. Whereas it's the opposite with Star Trek in the modern era. The issue is that they're coming up with new stuff and it has nothing to do with what people expect, which is the world building. And I think that if you're going to create a series like Star Trek, or you're going to create something that people are going to engage with on a franchise level, you have to do the due diligence to build the world from the inside out. And I think that that's something that's very difficult for certain kinds of writers. I don't know if Smug Boy would appreciate that. You know what I mean? He doesn't think that that's, as far as I know, I don't want to strawman him, but I remember talking to him about the order of how you write something, and the world building was sort of after the effect, you know, after you come up with what it is that you want. So
it's kind of weird because I kind of came up with my story the opposite. And even Mass Effect itself, they created the world before they actually created the story behind it.
Say that again? Sorry, my
So with Mass Effect originally, they developed the world before they developed the story.
How much do you think they came up with?
According to the behind the scenes that I looked at, they decided how the, like, it was the galaxy going to be in conflict, what the technology is going to be like, the history of all these alien races and how they've all came together. And Mass Effect wasn't even originally supposed to be the type of game it was at release. It was more of along the lines of, it was a strategy game, I believe. Yeah, it was originally not even, it was a completely different thing originally. Even before it was that strategy game, actually, I might be confusing it with Halo.
It might be Halo was going to be a third person thing. Hey, that was a little slightly.
It might just be very common for things to, at least back then, to change from one game to another. It could be both.
Well, I'm wondering.
I know for even more of a fact,
because they made a shooter out of it, right? And BioWare was known for making RPGs. Are you saying turn-based strategy? Is that what you meant by that? Like it was supposed to be a game where,
you have
your party, or okay? Because I was, my least favorite thing about Mass Effect was the actual gameplay. You know what I mean? I really, and not just the shooting necessarily, because that was kind of tolerable, but micromanagement of your units. Like I don't like managing my. If I have an AI partner, I want them to choose what armor they wear based on their own. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, I always told my partners to auto level up because I couldn't be bothered to deal with that.
Exactly. So I'm wondering if that's the case because let's say like all the races and all of the different pieces of technology and the way that the systems work are so clearly defined in Mass Effect. And then the plot seems to be a narrative that is kind of the destruction of the universe in a way. The overarching thing, it's like a galactic threat thing. But like I was saying earlier, if they decided that there wasn't some Reaper existential threat, I think that Mass Effect would still have the world building and the presentation to be able to tell whatever story that they actually wanted to. It could be about, it could just be about the Krogans. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They have that Star Trek quality where the factions are clearly defined.
And another thing that's very quickly just to touch upon, according to the original design documents, the original Mass Effect idea was to be more of an exploratory game like Star Trek, for example. And that's what they tried to play upon with Mass Effect Andromeda. With Mass Effect Andromeda, they found the original design documents of Mass Effect and tried to build a game around that. But then they failed massively.
The effect was a failure, a massive failure. Yeah, we should see if we can find some of those documents later after this episode and do a Mass Effect thing, maybe.
We'll talk. I'm sure that'd be very interesting to do. Another few super chats. $20 from Short Girl Shorts. The thing I love about Star Trek most about Star Trek is that I can show the original series to my two under 10 boys and the lessons in the writing will still hold up.
Absolutely. The family entertainment has sort of fallen by the wayside, and I don't know if that's, you know, I could, this is a political thing, blah blah blah, agenda, I'm not even gonna, you know, nuclear family, that kind of thing, I'm not going to try and get into that. But I like the idea of entertainment being for the whole family, and as a writer having to sort of moderate how raunchy it is while still keeping adults entertained. I think that the best example of that was The Simpsons. The Simpsons was the most broad spectrum comedic content that still had a moral that you could show to people that were of a variety of ages, and everybody would get something out of it, because the jokes affected pretty much the entirety of civilization. It was all about America, and anybody that lived in any kind of town that was anywhere between Springfield to Borger, Texas, would be able to identify with the characters. And I think Star Trek has that in the futuristic sense. Like, you can be a little kid and watch Star Trek, and if you're into the stuff, it's like science and cornball sci-fi stuff, then you're really going to be into it. And as an old man, you know, you can be like Mike Stiklas and watch it and get this really warm, nostalgic feeling or comfortable feeling of people that are doing the right thing. I love television for that. That's like the one saving grace that I have about entertainment, is that for a long amount of time, the goal was, I want to make a story. I want the moral of the story to be important, and I want things to work out for the characters. Like, even if my real life isn't like that, I still want that for my characters. I really enjoy that's part of the artistic process of family entertainment, and I would like more of that. I would like more children-oriented content that adults also get into. I think, like, SpongeBob is like that. Can you name any of those, Shiney, that you think are family-friendly, that are edgy enough for teenagers to watch it, friendly enough for kids to watch it, and also wise enough and experienced enough writers that can write stuff that adults will pick up on?
What springs to mind is the Justice League animated series, or even the DC animated universe in general, where it's it very much treats the audience kind of like adults, and it's telling a somewhat serious story, but it's still very entertaining for kids at the exact same time. Or even Clone Wars, possibly, to an extent, even though that's made for like more teen, like 14-year-old teenage audience, it still resonates a lot with a lot of adults.
Have you seen Back to the Future?
Yes, obviously, of course, right? I've seen Back to the Future. What the fuck do you take me for?
Dude, I didn't see Back to the Future for like most of my life. You know what I mean? There was a lot of films when I was a kid, I intentionally didn't watch for a long time, just so that I could save up a good, like, I knew it would be good, but I didn't want to watch it yet. That kind of thing. Like, I have a bunch of Tarkovsky films that I haven't watched yet. Like, I haven't seen Come and See, which is another one of those Russian films that's really good, and I know I'm going to love it. I haven't watched the Chernobyl series from HBO yet, because I know I'm going to love it, and it's a specific mood. You know what I mean? I didn't watch when I was a kid, but now after
I know from that show that there is a lot of, like, realism, inaccuracies. Like, the amount of people that they suggest are going to die from Chernobyl. Yeah.
I haven't seen it, so I can't comment on it. But what I read was that there were some people that saw them, like, characters playing themselves, and they were like, yes, that was exactly it. And then there are people that are like, yeah, that's not right. And then there's a composite character.
Well, I was talking more about characters. Like, for example, I think, just from what I've been told, they say that the death count would have been estimated as so-and-so or so-and-so, when actually it probably would have been a lot less than what they claim.
It's hard to calculate, because I was reading about a lot of these radiological incidents, because my grandfather was a nuclear scientist, an engineer on the first... This is funny how this ties into it. There was a ship called the NS Savannah. My grandfather was on that ship as somebody that worked with the nuclear engines. It was the first commercial cruise ship to be powered by nuclear powered, because it was part of the Atoms for Peace program that at the time, I think it was like a Kennedy program. And this ship, the Savannah, I'm going to actually show you something. I need to look it up. The Savannah was a ship that Gene Roddenberry toured. And I think that was one of his... the foundation for what the Enterprise was, because it was a research ship where families could be aboard and everybody was having a good time. And they even have a lounge that has the logo of Star Trek on it before Star Trek even existed. So where was I coming from this? What was the question thing again that I was responding to? I kind of got off onto a tangent.
I think you just came up with a tangent after talking about Chernobyl.
Oh, Chernobyl, that's right. Okay, so like calculating how the effects of radiation over the long course of time are going to be, it's really hard to do that. You know what I'm saying? It's hard to say, okay, this esophageal cancer that this person got 2 years later, it's not related to Fukushima Daiichi. It's like, how would you know? Or somebody died in 2004 of something. How would you know? You know, and medium to low level radiation incidents that happen all the time near processing plants like Mayak or whatever, or Ozersk or whatever it is in Russia. Like, there are closed cities where they have these nuclear things, or Los Alamos Laboratory. There's probably countless people that have gotten sick from radiation poisoning. We just have no idea. You know what I mean? There's just no, because it's such a sensitive issue. It's the cross section between nuclear weapons, mutually assured destruction, almost unlimited energy, and environmentalism. I'm personally way against nuclear stuff, but there's no way to stop it. You know what I mean? It's like that. It's so important to nuclear energy is so important to cyclotrons and to research into particle physics, as well as generating something like 30% of Japan's energy source. It's so cost effective and efficient that we will poison ourselves to actually have it. You know what I mean? So it's like, for a show to be accurate about something that was an international atomic incident that was probably covered up to a certain degree by the Soviet Union, where there's still people claiming that it was the CIA that blew it up or whatever, you know what I mean? I don't think that we're ever going to get a straight answer. And that, to me, is the fear of the nuclear age, is that it's like, it's what you can't see, you can't detect it, and you still have to deal with it. And that's the fear that I have. So when I was watching content that was around Chernobyl, and I was seeing, like, reading interviews, it was very interesting for people to be like, yeah, that's me, and then the other person going, no, that didn't happen, this helicopter crash happened a week later and stuff. And what I've noticed is that a lot of the criticism of that show is people just upset not that it was inaccurate, but that it's biased. You're biased, you're showing off the Soviets like they're evil people for not doing X or Y. And it's like, well, you have to make a judgment, and you have to abridge certain things. You have to combine certain characters together to tell the story.
I mean, were the Soviets, like, they weren't exactly known for being incredibly moral, like, as a government.
They were known for being forthcoming, at the very least. Mm. They're not going to tell their enemies that they made a huge mistake, but neither would we, which is why it's so fucking...
Well, we still know, like, of all the mistakes of the British and the American governments. For example, all the time the American governments, the government lost the fucking nukes. How many did you end up losing? We know for a fact that the Soviet government have lost nukes in the past. They just didn't tell anyone how many they've lost, managed to recover the ones they lost.
I'm pretty sure the Barents Sea has, like, radioactive shit at the bottom of it because of the Russians. And like, even up until 2019, like, they don't tell you. There was an explosion, and all these radiological arrays picked it up. And the Russians were like, no, nothing happened. Totally nothing happened. And then these pontoons that were super irradiated showed up on the beach. And they're like, no, nothing happened, guys. Don't look here.
They just kicks it under the rug.
I don't know about that.
Anyway, I'm very sorry, Mexican Iron Man, that you're... Super chat has been just floating here for 10 minutes. I'll quickly read it.
Here,
I agree with
read it off, and I want to. I'm sending
Shady
the...
and Glib.
Shady, by the way, I have an idea. Shady should be your purge trooper outfit. That's Shady. So shiny is when you're white and blue, and then when you're black and red, you can be Shady.
I need some black voice mode. I'm Shady.
That's terrible.
What would his voice be?
I'm Shady. Shady effects.
I've got to have, like, the Vader voice.
Yeah, you got to have, like, the voice just to be lowered, and then
I don't have lazy voice mod installed right now, and it doesn't like to work with NVIDIA Broadcast anyway.
I sent you the lounge of the NS Savannah, where you can see that they had a Trek-like logo on the tables there, which I thought was really interesting, because there's that's an apocryphal story that I said, where Gene visited this Savannah ship. And I think that's the basis for it.
Oh, you mean with the stars?
Yeah, and this ship was designed in the 50s.
It's a very common thing in the American military, like the star.
No, look on the table. You see that, the Star Trek logo? Yeah.
Like the little stars in a circle.
The swoop. The little swoop mm-hmm. icon. Yeah. Yeah. That's, I'm like, how did you get that? Is it because it's the NASA logo, or, like, it's not, though?
Well, even it's derived, or NASA derived its logo from other things. So it's like a derivative of a lot of, like, derivative of a derivative. Fuck, I'm fucked that up. Anyway.
Yeah, I mean, if you look it so, up, there's a lot
quickly,
of...
I've got to finish this super chat. Make some excellent points. Also, I thought of it in the way that Chris Raposo commented it, but it seems very accurate. Glib, I agree with your analysis. Trek versus Wars, world building. You know, if you want to send a longer super chat, Streamlabs actually allows you to send longer ones that we could read off. Sorry it took so long to get to your super chat. And just making sure there's not over. Okay, we're fine. We're safe.
But yeah, I'm convinced that because the color of the room that I sent you, that green, is the same color as the transporter room, as far as I know.
Mm-hmm.
So I would definitely be fine with putting forward the idea that the Enterprise is based on the nuclear ship Savannah, which was part of the Ask for Peace program, and that's the reason why justified the ship is what it is. It's more of a cruise ship. It's more of a research vessel that people can be a part of than a military ship. And I think that was what inspired him. But that's an apocryphal story. I don't know if I have details on it. But the ship was built in 1959. So it'd be interesting if that was the inspiration.
Can we continue with the video?
Yeah.
The original pilot was really a lot different from the shows that we know today, wasn't it?
Yes, the original pilot even had a different captain, Jeff Hunter, who's a fine actor. The only people that were in the original that stayed over was Leonard Nimoy, although he looks quite a bit different then, and he was not the emotionless Vulcan then. Yeah.
So I heard
to grin.
I'm going to pause really quick. I heard that the reason why, from Leonard Nimoy, the reason why Hunter was replaced with Kirk and it worked, Shatner, was because Hunter was like an internal actor, like a reactive, you know what I mean? You play off of his face and his reaction to other characters, but so is Nimoy. They're both playing kind of the passive actor that intakes information, and you see it play on his face, how the resultant effects of that action is. Meanwhile, Shatner is boisterous. Shatner is an external extroverted actor who puts the energy, he throws the energy towards you, which is why he can throw the energy towards Nimoy and he can just move his eyebrow and get a laugh out of it. Or McCoy can come back and snap back at Shatner and be like, yeah, you know, Kirk, you gotta blah, blah, blah. You know, you gotta.
There's a lot more chemistry.
Right, exactly. Meanwhile, Hunter is there and he's very quiet. He's a great actor and everybody gave him all these accolades, but it wasn't right for the lead of the show who needed to drive all the intensity of all the action. You know, the person that's going to be sitting there saying, you know, red alert, he has to have energy. He has to, the captain has to be able to put out that energy, which is different with Picard, I think, because he was surrounded by other types of characters that were very, very strong from their roles perspective, which is something that I don't think was really that emphasized in the original. You have Uhura and she's like, I got a call from the radio and that kind of thing, but that's not as like emotionally important, I think, as someone like Guinan, right? Where she's intrinsic to characters changing in an arc sense, as opposed to just fulfilling a function. And you have someone like Data who's going to be replacing the Spock character, but has a different affectation. And the affectation of Spock is going to be taken by somebody else. You know, you're going to have Geordi, you're going to have these other characters that are going to be not necessarily reflections of the personality of the characters, but still fill the same roles, which I think is
interesting. And similar with Voyager, how they turned Data into a mix of, was it like they had the logical character, which was... Tuvok, and at the exact mm-hmm. same time they split that also into those like the EMH, yeah, the human, yeah. Was it the synthetic person trying to be more human kind of element?
Yes, I agree with that. So it's much better. It's much better.
EMH is still the best character in Voyager. Fight me.
Still the best character. I would put Tuvok afterwards, but I would say that Tuvok would have been better on a different show. Because I love that actor. I think he's great in the role.
With Tim Russ?
God, I hate Voyager. Yeah, Tim Russ is good.
I have a lot of criticism of Voyager. I used to like love it growing up, but then after I look back at it now, it's like, I hate this. Like even episodes like Equinox, I hate it because of how much potential it has and how much they could do with it, but how much it just falls short.
I like what Sketch said here. I don't care. Spock is like, I don't care. It's against my culture. Yeah, that's true. And then Data is like, I don't care, but I want to care. That's a very interesting distinction. Yeah. One is I shouldn't. And the other one is I can't. That's a very interesting distinction. And then the other thing that I saw that was from a while ago, I know you got a super chat, but I want to just ask this before we get to that, which is somebody mentioned like androids and toasters. Like, what do you think of, we can read the super chat and then afterwards I want to ask you about what you think about artificial intelligence, like Measure of a Man stuff.
All right. Andrew Clark for $2. Shady should have a Cockney accent. Great show, by the way.
Oh, it's me, Shady FX over here. Whatever the fuck.
And that's not going to be very intimidating, though.
That'd be really funny if a Purge Trooper showed up and he was all evil-looking and he had a Cockney accent. I'd love that.
So, the question was, what's my thought about artificial intelligence?
At what point, because this is a deep question, at what point does the facsimile of humanity become actually human? What is it, the biology? Is it the mentality? Because I always thought on Measure of a Man that clearly Data, because he can speak for himself and he can assert what he wants, he's not a machine. So I think that self-recognition and self-determination is what defines an organism to be conscious and sentient. And at that point, you have to respect it in that sense. You know what I mean? You can't treat a mechanistic version of humanity that looks in the mirror and goes, oh God, I'm this thing. You can't look at that like it's not a person in a way. That is personhood to me.
Quite honestly, after all the kind of AI media which I've consumed, and like either being Mass Effect or Star Trek or even to a lesser degree Star Wars, I really struggle with it, the question, because I really don't know. I used to be a lot more sure of myself. It's like, yeah, AI, obviously, people. And then you start to get into the deeper questions of like, okay, well, you can just make thousands of these things, and then what happens to the population? And then is it really, or is it like personality, or is it just what's kind of programmed? And then you don't really have any kind of set criteria or standards for how exactly you define where the line between programming and actual intelligence, like a self-determined person is. Because you can tell a robot to be, you know, conscious of it itself, or like even to act on its own and what it wants. But then again, isn't that still programming? That at the end of the day, then how do you find people, like actual life, like biological life? Because to an extent, that is also biological hardware with some kind of software running in the brain.
Wetware.
It's not programmed by any kind of god or being. It's purely what has been written by itself.
Well, then that's how you get to the ontological, epistemological argument of how did the world get created? Because
yeah, but I...
Well, I know.
That's why I say I don't know anyway, because I used to be a lot more sure of the question, and now I just don't know.
Let me just finish by saying that when you're in the universe, you can't take an external view of it, so you can only assume stuff. So I think that when you're in the seat of consciousness, all you can do is think about what it means to be conscious or whatever. And so like when you have physical, biological material versus material that's like, I don't know what Data is made out of, fiber optics and stuff, you know what I mean? It's frustrating to make that differentiation, because you want to treat somebody that is showing off their humanity, as it were, as a human. But then there's a distinction with the programming. And then reflectively, you realize that, okay, well, maybe there's a biological element to our programming, or a mechanistic element. So how much of my consciousness is actually independent of my physical needs, is independent of my my own biological programming. And that's like one of the only things that I really enjoyed about Blade Runner 2049, was that he's got an artificial waifu girlfriend that will tell him anything that he wants to hear, but he wants to believe in it. And then he's got all these other replicants that are running around, and he treats them poorly, as if they're, you know, substandard, even though he is in love with a fake human, right? Like that he can't even touch. He doesn't want to touch a replicant, and he doesn't feel worthy of being with a human, or isn't interested in the humans that are around him. So what stage do you become human? And I think what's really scary for people is not robots gaining humanity. I think that that's what people like. I think what people are afraid of is that humans will degrade into robots or animals, because then you're losing. It's like this idea of ascending to greater heights as opposed to being taken down to lower, you know. Maybe it's us projecting how we treat mechanical objects and how we deny them any kind of, you know, humanity. Like, you don't look at a trailer hitch and feel bad about it, even though after a certain amount of time, you got to replace that shit because it's getting so beat up or something after like 50 years. I mean, probably not, but you get what I'm saying. Like, immaterial or material objects, you don't feel necessarily as bad about as if you see somebody get hit in the face that you know, and you're like, hey, that hurts my feelings, you know what I mean, or what have you. So I don't have like a hard line on this. All I know is that I'm excited for new emergent forms of intelligence that are able to be that have self-affirmation, that can tell you that they're alive. That's what's interesting to me. That's why I'm so fascinated by the Blade Runner stuff that I've been working on, because in the story that I've been working on with Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, Philip K. Dick was basically saying that he saw androids and replicants as lower than humans. They were not able to be empathetic. He was saying that the thing that makes humans human is empathy. He was also saying that for prey animals, human beings and like omnivores were the only form of life that feels bad about consuming other life to sustain ours. For some reason, we don't like killing animals to feed ourselves. I don't know if that's because we think that there's a better, more efficient way, or if there's something that's going on here that's spiritual. I don't know what it is. But this idea that you can empathize with your prey is what separates the reflex machine androids from Blade Runner, well, from Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, from the humans. And then when you have something like Ridley Scott's take on artificial humans, he sees them as the next step in human evolution. So there's this dichotomy of ideas where one person is deathly afraid that humanity and the empathetic, you know, the natural born humans are going to lose to psychopathic android machine wetware, versus somebody who sees us genetically engineering a eugenics cast of superhumans that could live longer than us, you know what I mean? And there's probably somewhere in the middle is what's actually going to happen. The line will probably be blurred when we have artificial humans that we create that are almost the same as naturally born humans with modifications to their, you know what I mean? There's no way we're avoiding a future without augmented children, as much as we hate to say that, like designer babies. Like, that's totally in our future if we want it to be. And as a people, I don't know how that's going to stop without some sort of spirituality, which is interesting to talk about in regards to Star Trek, because there's an ethical basis, but there's like no religion in it. So how do you ethically avoid certain issues? Well, they have the prime directive. Their religion is essentially the prime directive, which is that all life in different stages has a right to exist. So I don't know what the line between android and human and organic and unrealistic or whatever being is, but I know that the prime directive is an interesting way of looking at it, because it's basically, you know, you can talk about how like there's moments with the crystalline entity where it's killing a bunch of people, and then Picard is like, no, we can't kill it because it doesn't know any better than we do. So where you value your people versus the other is really the line of distinction, I think, between that. If you think that Data is part of our humanity and part of our crew, then he is. And if you think that he's some sort of external thing or piece of property, then he could be as well. It's all a matter of perspective, which is an issue, because there can't be a consistent perspective across different people. Everybody's going to have their own view of it. And really, when this actually happens in our life, it's not going to be something that we're going to have a say in. It's going to be like everything else. It's going to be the natural process of science and without the ethical guidelines. So what's interesting to me is that I want to pull it back around. My favorite line in 2049 is when Kay goes to meet up with Deckard, and there's a dog, and Deckard pours a little bit of scotch for the dog, and Kay goes, "Is it real?" And Deckard says, "I don't know. Ask him." That's the key. That's the answer to all the questions. Is if somebody's real or if they're a real person, you just ask that person or Android or whatever and see what they come up with. Because that's the real answer. That's the real question that I have anyway. Is if you're going to meet somebody like an alien, you're going to meet a robot or some sort of form of extraterrestrial intelligence. It's like, my opinion on it isn't important. I'm just curious about what the experience would be. What's their opinion of me? What's their opinion of themselves? Because that point perspective of where the consciousness is the question. And the answer to the question is in the question. It's like, oh, let them tell you. So I don't know. That's our diet. That's our aside on.
How do we keep going on such like tangents all the time?
Best
not like anything unique to this. It's just something we always end up doing.
Well, to be honest, that's the point of the show in my mind. It's like we start with something, and then because we exist, like this all was in 1986. It's been what, you know, 40 years, almost 35 years. So where are we now? Well, I think the ethical dilemmas that he was pointing out are timeless, and I think that that's why the show lives on, even though the aesthetics or the production value or whatever don't. You still get the same experience of, what do you mean by this story? What's the morals? And I think that that's what keeps it timeless, along with the writer's guide. It's like, here's the rules of the show, of how you create a show, and then the content of the show is going to stay ephemeral evergreen, because the issues are not resolved in humanity yet. As long as these issues aren't resolved by the current tense, it'll still be futuristic.
Nervousness in that first pilot.
Records show the tallest group has never been explored. Solar system similar to Earth, 11 planets. Number 4 seems to be class M. Oxygen atmosphere.
It's hard to think about it now with all the success of Star Trek, but the original series that ran on TV was not that big a hit.
No, it was only with young-minded people. But we were quite a different United States then. One can over-intellectualize what we did on Star Trek, but we always told stories of action, adventure. There was always a want, a need, a goal, feelings, and we were the only show, for example, during all of the dreadful Vietnam affair, only dramatic show that ever talked against Vietnam. But as in the case of Jonathan Swift, we set it on another planet.
If this planet is to develop in the way it should, we must equalize both sides again. Jim, that means you're condemning this whole planet to a war that may never end. It could go on for year after year, massacre after massacre.
Oh,
playing essentially the role of our presidents in those years where he'd gotten into it and he was having trouble getting out of it. And it's
like
a pity. Vietnam would have ended many years sooner if it had been on dramatic shows on television, because the impact of these dramatic shows. I have two aunts, for example, maiden aunts. If Dr. Marcus Welby had come out and said something against Vietnam, my aunts would have carried placards.
Do you remember the 20th century brush wars on the Asian continent? It went on bloody year after bloody year. But what would you have suggested? The only solution is what happened back then. Balance of power.
Mass communications is our language today between one another. And we can't say, let's not really talk about anything serious on television. That is a criminal statement and a criminal intention. In my opinion, the audience is way ahead of our government leaders. I think the government leaders should catch up with the audience, and then we'd have 21st century dreams right now.
Many such journeys are possible. Let me be your gateway.
Captain, the Enterprise.
I think this is my favorite episode, Sitting on the Edge of Forever.
I was going to make a different comment, but I remember that this focused is on like the media itself, but never mind, because that's more of a social, political thing.
We're asking if we want to
I thought it was actually really interesting. That whole episode's dilemma, where there are, you know, it's like,
the audience, like the audience are ahead of or whatever.
Well, I mean, I don't know about that, but what I thought was interesting was that the dilemma with the Prime Directive is that Roddenberry and the writers are basically saying that you have to let people work out what stage of humanity that they're in, and that the future, they're looking at the past they're just like us. They're looking at the past as a blueprint for what would happen this time if you did this, right? And I think mm-hmm. that the whole idea of Star Trek is like, we're looking at the past, we solved the problem, and then the issue is now that when faced with the issues again, they find themselves actually having to act out the same dilemmas. Like, even if you get far away from it in the future, you're still going to have people having battles and wars. And if they're convinced that they have to do that, how do you stop them without stopping their development? Interventionism is basically what that episode is about. I don't think that you can intervene necessarily in somebody else's business and teach them the right way to do something without them wanting to resist against you. It creates a different effect. And so then, do you let people fail on their own merit, or do you try to show them the light? That was kind of what the show was wrestling with. Do we force people to be enlightened? Can you force people to educate themselves? I don't think so, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you can force people to do something, and it's just the ethical question of if that's the right thing to do or not.
Well, I think it rings pretty true that you can't just mess with people's development. And this is something which has been picked up on not just in Star Trek, but also things like Mass Effect as well. What happened with the Krogan? But I'm going to move a bit away from Mass Effect because I know not everyone has played those games. But if, for example, you give a caveman a nuclear bomb, what's going to fucking happen? It's going to go terribly. If today, for example, you suddenly gave our civilization incredibly advanced technology, it would completely destroy like the world. Maybe not just physically destroy it, but it would shake the world so much with how much things rapidly develop, like at like the social element is not catching up with the social society element is not catching up with the technological. You're disrupting the balance there, because it's everything's about exceeding some kind of limitation, and like there's social consequences and lessons to be learned from every kind of technological bound, like how we've learned from the Cold War, for example, and how actually because if you gave nuclear weapons before the humanity was ready for them, it would destroy vessels. Everything. Nuclear whistles.
Yeah, I agree with you. If you interrupted the process, then it would destroy the paradigm, whatever mm-hmm. the current day is. And there's the
if you gave many people weapons, they gave medieval knights guns, for example, it would completely fuck with the entire society.
And the future of history would be completely altered. So there's like, of course, the temporal prime directive, which goes back into the Star Trek thing, but as for just making decisions in the current time period based on technological advances, I think that that's basically how we get these outcroppings, like how Bitcoin has changed things or how the internet changed things. And then we have to adapt back to some sort of moderate standard that we have. It seems to be inherently what we try to do. We try to keep a balance, which is what he was saying in the episode. There's a balance of power that's required or else things will fall apart. But like, the moral quandary that McCoy has is that he knows, and the same thing happens with Picard and TNG, is that if you know better, does that mean you're responsible for it? If you know something that people don't know, I mean, one of my least favorite things about who watches The Watchers is the way that they resolve this civilization, which clearly is like able to comprehend at least the smartest person in the village. Like they understand everything that Picard is telling them. Right. So if they started to educate people on where the actual temporal, where they were in the future, like, hey, did you know that there are other people that are like you that have space traveling stuff? Like if somebody came down to us, some alien race, and was saying, yeah, you guys are like really primitive in comparison to what the standard is for the rest of the universe for upright corporeal humanoid beings, would you rather continue to exist in the world that we've created for ourselves, or would you rather exist in a world that the technology already exists and you're not figuring it out for yourself? I don't know if I want to live not knowing whatever the most technological race is, not knowing what they know. I don't think that would be cool. I would much prefer to get that information. Like, just give
me
the
answers.
Isn't
that what they play upon in Star Trek Enterprise as well? Like, so yeah. The Vulcans don't tell the humans like what they know, they just let them figure out for themselves.
Yes, but then you have Star Trek 4 where they're like, to get back to the future, they need they invent transparent aluminum and break the rules, right? So it's one of those things where what is most
convenient? We didn't invent it, laddie.
That's the ticket, laddie. It's like, it's been stupid because it's like, yeah, when think about all the people whose lives would be changed for the better by this kind of technology. If they came out tomorrow and said, we have a cure for cancer, all of the people that had people that died around them from cancer in the last year would be fucking pissed. You're like, what the hell? All that. And then that gets into the Who Watches the Watchers problem where they're saying, can you bring back our dead? All these people died. And then Picard is like, no, we're not that advanced. We can't do that. But if you could do that, that would create a new ethical and moral question. Should you do that? At what point does the Prime Directive no longer be the right decision? At what point do you have to take responsibility for the knowledge capacity of other races and species and stuff? And that's very interesting to compare to a private little war where they're saying, no, you really just have to let people figure things out for themselves, even if it costs other people around them. I don't know if that's the right ethical answer to the solution, but I don't know. I haven't seen all I know is that the Prometheus story where he brings down fire, the gods punish him, but humans love Prometheus for doing that. It's like a favor to us. And, you know, Hercules and all that, rescuing him for being punished by the Titans for revealing something. I don't know if it's preferred to accept where you are in time and space or to try and strive for beyond that when that's the goal, right? Like, if somebody else has a piece of technology, shouldn't you copy what they're, you know? It's like soap. If soap was not in the collective consciousness of civilization, do you let them still be dirty or do you give them soap and teach them how to make it? What kind of analogy is this? Because it's like any piece of technology, you know, soap is a piece of technology. Antibiotics are a piece of technology. And the ethics around a piece of technology are on how they affect human life, how they affect the right of life to death. That's basically what we're talking about. During my life, technology has changed substantially, like the internet. So if the internet didn't exist, right, and let's say the aliens invented the internet, right, and we just didn't have it, would it be moral and ethical for them to give us the internet, or would we have to figure that out ourselves? Which is more ethically acceptable to someone like Roddenberry or to somebody with the optimistic view of the future? Do you let people catch up to you, or do you give them the ability to do that immediately? I don't know. I don't have an answer for that. I just disagree with Who Watches the Watchers based on like the fact that you're dooming this woman to never be able to be on a spaceship again, even though they will be flying around the galaxy, you know?
Got a super chat from Andrew Clark for $2. What do you think of her final conflict? I don't know. I've never seen it.
We'll watch that. We'll do that. That's Roddenberry's other project, right? Because I feel like his vision of Star Trek. I feel like his vision of Star Trek is based on the after the apocalypse. So I'm very curious about. When an alien species comes to Earth, bearing gifts for humanity, a few suspicious humans seek to discover and resist the newcomer's true intent. Yeah, that sounds like exactly like the opposite of the.
It's got a 6.2 rating.
That's okay. I'm okay with that. I'll check it out. Yeah, that sounds like exactly what I'm curious about.
Gene Roddenberry, very creative and very nice man.
That's it. All right,
yeah.
What else would you want to cover?
Why would I care if it's moral for them? If it's good for us, who cares? I mean, that's the pragmatist view of it. Did you want to go over the writer's guide here, or did you want to watch another video, or what do you we got an hour and 20 minutes in?
What did you want to go over with the writer's guide specifically, or did you want to go through the entire thing?
I think that'll probably take hours to go over it.
So is there anything specifically that you wanted to cover within the writer's guide?
No, I wanted to do the whole thing. I wanted to read it just for the sake of reading it, you know what I mean? No, I mean, if you want to keep doing other stuff, if you want to watch some of these other behind-the-scenes things and discuss some of them.
I think it's probably best to watch some of the other behind-the-scenes stuff. Not that I'm not interested in the writer's guide.
Okay, well, I think you should turn on the Empire of Dreams thing if you can do that with the production thing, and we'll ride that out a little bit.
All right, we'll give it a go.
Because I still, just for chat and for everybody that we know, we haven't really worked out the meat and potatoes of this. We don't know exactly what the format is. But if you guys have suggestions about what you think you've been seeing so far, you know, this is kind of the EFAP format, but just with a different subject matter. So just let us know what you think. And yes, Feeble Goblin, I think Dying Light 2 will be good. I do. Dying Light is an overwhelmingly positive review on Steam, and I think that's interesting because I personally enjoy it. I don't really like RPG mechanics when it comes to damage in first-person games, like twitchy games. But the fact that they have wall running in it or wall jumping or whatever, and they're really caring about the movement set, I think that that's going to be really good. I'm going to pre-order it. I like Techland too because I think that they try. I like Polish developers.
I'm Luke Skywalker. I'm here to rescue you.
It's the fucking coolest shit in the world. It's Star Wars. Yeah. A legend of all time.
I honestly thought that that was in the documentary there. It's the fucking greatest thing of all time.
Yeah, that's the way that they advertise it. It's like an adventure that started at the beginning of no adventure at all. George Lucas, just a kid from a small town in the middle of nowhere. Like, yeah, they always do that. You got to hype it up.
It's always the exact same voice as well. Like, even if you go to like the very old trailers of like Star Wars with Star Wars Galaxies in 2003 when they were doing those trailers.
Oh yeah!
Finally, the galaxy is in your hands.
Oh, my least favorite one is where it's like a quiet piano and there's no voice and it's just like what was it? The Rise of Skywalker show. It's like every generation has a hero and a saga or whatever. It's like no, we don't. You don't know that. Fuck off.
It's one of the most groundbreaking sagas in Hollywood history.
Titty fucking
it captured imagination
chocolate dick
irresistible force.
Are you sure this music isn't gonna get us canceled?
Oh, the music is gonna get caught after the fact, but when we were testing it last time, there was no copyright thing up until like when I woke up this morning.
And all right, this is a stream. Health is excellent, so we're fine. So far. Into a larger work.
And you're taking your first step into my ass.
I got it! Great kid! Don't get cocky!
Everything about this movie changed by is the fucking awesome.
That came to me through the success of Star Wars.
It really is a wonderful morality tale.
I'll never turn to the dark side.
It's George's vision. And he truly is a visual man in a profound way.
But the
Star
Wars
trilogy I definitely agree that there's a lot of imagination with George Lucas. Like he must have a visual imagination, because like the way he comes up with all these like shots and cinematography and the way he's like sets things up, it's pretty interesting. It's always unique. But then when you look at that compared to, for example, the shot compositions and everything is framed in the sequel trilogy, it's like a lot more ecstatic, like especially if you're comparing for the fight scene with in the throne room.
Well, it depends like, on it's who you're all talking about.
Just kind of.
It depends on if you're talking about Rian Johnson's stuff or JJ, because they have completely different styles and different DPs.
Well, I would say they both lack that kind of imagination and vision, because I would say with Rian Johnson, he's a lot more incredibly basic with his
Absolutely.
Like cinematography and composition. Absolutely. Especially
it's
when
so
you just
fucking boring to look at his shit. If it's like the best thing that he made was Brick, but if you look at it, it's just so bog standard, like 45 degree angle offset, now reverse. It's like, fuck off. Like,
it's like every... I remember when I was first learning about like cinematography a few years back, they gave me a sheet of just all these different kinds of shots and their definitions. And it kind of feels like someone just kind of went down the list of all these things. It's like, okay, so we got a close-up shot, then this, then a reverse shot, then a panning shot. It's like, okay, could you maybe do something a bit more interesting, a bit more vision there? But with JJ, it's almost kind of like the opposite. where it's still lacking any kind of vision, but it's always just moving unnecessarily. I think, well, I can't remember what film it was. It was one of his where he had the camera spin around the actors, despite the fact it made no fucking sense and it just was incredibly nauseating. It's like, oh no, but it gives so much more energy to the scene. It's like, no, it doesn't. It's stupid. Stop it, JJ.
I think that Yedlin, who is the DP on the Rian Johnson pictures, is just kind of a boring, like, it's not bad shot composition. It's clearly influenced by older world film, which is why it's so static, like you're saying. I don't have a problem with static stuff, but what I have a problem with is that I feel like Rian Johnson just doesn't really care about framing as much as other people. Like George Lucas, if you look at all of his framing from American Graffiti, it's so specific, and like it's all meant to be epic. Like it's a very, very key aspect of his style is this large vista stuff that's kind of similar to John Ford. And really what the thing is that makes George Lucas stand out is that he had a bunch of peers that pushed him as hard as possible. I mean, he was working with Francis Ford Coppola, Martin Scorsese, John Milius, Steven Spielberg, and all these people that were around him were fantastic filmmakers on their own, and he was competing with them, including Brian De Palma, who was older than them. So it's like all these people, the greatest filmmakers of their age, in their youth, in their prime, and George is trying to distinguish himself from them. How do you do that? Well, part of it is the fact that he really cared about the quality of the picture. Part of that was that he was replicating content from other film directors and creators. And then a lot of that is his own personal experience. Like, he has a very specific kind of way of looking at the world and experiencing it and what the content is. Like, all of his films are personal films. It's just hard to see that underneath the layers of genre stuff that he adds on top of it. I think the best way to show it is if you could, I'm going to link you something and hopefully we can play it. There's like this little segment from American Graffiti that shows exactly what I'm talking about. Do you want to put that up real quick?
Yeah, I'll pull it up.
I think we can get away with that. It'll just illustrate the difference between the generic look that someone like Rian Johnson has. You see, first off, pause real quick. See how it's like the rule of thirds is in effect, and there's a vanishing point all the way at the end where the cars are coming from.
Mm-hmm.
You see that? That's cinematography right there. That's the ability and how the horizon is meeting at that one point with the vanishing point. And you can see the electric lines. It's all leading to a singular point, one point perspective shot, offset with the rule of thirds. So it has a very aesthetic look. You're going to be able to get the parallax of them coming past the camera and all of that. It's action without moving the camera. So play it. If the audio is going to pick up, you can just mute it for music segments.
Yeah, I'll keep my eye on the live stream health.
Okay. So, just as a preamble, what's happening here, this drag race, this is what they used to do in Modesto, California, which is what this film is based on. There's Han Solo.
Yeah, she's going with me. You take care of yourself, man. You guys ready?
There's George. The nerdy. But look at these shots. Like, all of these shots, they're very distinct, and they tell a story by the frame. And the low angle. Look at that shot. Almost all of them are one point perspective shots that have to do with the epic stuff. Oh, right by the camera. Like that wide shot. So he's got a visually distinct style, and it's mostly wide shots far back, except for the shots that are meant to be close-ups on the characters' reactions to things. And the original Gilbert Taylor, A New Hope, is very very into that. Empire Strikes Back adds a little bit of action to that, and Return of the Jedi starts to fall. It starts to fall off. By the time that we get to the prequels, it's basic filmmaking. You're not going to get these large vista shots because he's not out there in nature or whatever trying to look for the shot.
Warning, heads up, we detected copyrighted audio and visuals on your stream.
That's okay. We got it. As long as people saw it, then we got it.
Your stream may be temporarily blocked. Oops. Well, hopefully we're still fine. I think we might have got it just in time. I just got warned.
Yeah, I think we're good.
We're fine?
So we can go back to the other thing. I just wanted to point out that the way that George characterizes his shots is very John Ford influenced. It's very Kurosawa influenced, where he's trying to catch the action in as wide a shot as possible so that the audience is able to intake all of the information about what is happening and where it's happening. And then when I was watching the Yedlin Last Jedi stuff, it's like, the screen space doesn't feel that way. You don't get these nice vista shots in the same way. It's like, it just feels like I'm watching a television show, if that makes any sense. It just feels more indie and less epic. I don't know how else to describe it.
So just checking everything's fine. Yeah, it seems to be. I'll put on the
you can do
the Empire of Dreams again.
I think that there's a segment. If you just look, like, you can cut it out. Well, we'll just do the intro, and maybe we'll continue watching this over the course. I want to do maybe like 25 more minutes or something like that. Other show, right. And then
just
get some breakfast.
Changed the way we look at movies. It changed the way that movies are made.
You must unlearn what you have learned.
There's so many accomplishments that George has done that really has changed the business as we know it.
We did it.
That's why it's hard to hate on him for making the prequels the way that they looked. Like, he's advancing film to such a degree that he knew what was coming and he was ahead of the curve. Like, all of the Unreal Engine stuff, all the virtual stage stuff that we do today, he was on top of it. He already knew that. He knew that's where we were going with it. Just by the nature of the business and by the nature of what he wanted to do, that was what it was going to be.
And I still love a lot of the visual designs that he had created for the prequels, like the Arc 170. Gorgeous design, chef's kiss. And then the Venator of the Star Destroyer, I love that as well. The ATT, absolutely gorgeous. And I think one of my favorite ones is the A-2, the Jedi Starfighter from Revenge of the Sith.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's another absolutely gorgeous design. And I love that they're extremely good examples of designs which have been broken that down to their base components and put together again, so that you can visually see that this is the same thing, but it's also different. This is something which KOTOR was extremely good at as well, as Knights of the Old Republic, where they took designs, like, for example, the astromech droids. They broke down the basic elements of the astromech droids and then made those into the utility droids. They look nothing alike, but at the exact same time, they share a lot of common elements that you can visually see that this is a technological precursor to the astromech.
Mm-hmm. I have so many good ideas for I can't even talk about because the sci-fi stuff. We'll have to discuss that outside the stream, unfortunately. That had
Fair
to
enough.
Do with designs and ships and stuff, because it would breach the thing that I'm writing, which is something I haven't seen. I haven't seen the concepts that I'm working with, so I don't want to put them out there yet. I got to copyright them first.
Became a success story beyond one man's wildest dreams.
The Force will be with you, always.
I expected not to ever make a hit movie. That wasn't my agenda. I certainly didn't expect Star Wars to be this giant hit.
I love this idea that, like, he's making this film and he's like, all right, I think it'll work. Like, and then he just has no belief or faith that it actually will. He's like, I don't think it's gonna work. I like this idea that George is like this sad guy, and then all of his friends, like Francis Ford Coppola, are like, no, you gotta go out and make a movie, George. Come on. You're a really talented guy. You gotta go out and do that. I get this impression. And I remember watching Back to the Future again, because I love that movie, and I was thinking, wow, this movie's made by Robert Zemeckis. It's produced by Steven Spielberg, and there's a character in it called Marty. I wonder if he's named after Martin Scorsese. There's a character named George in it. I wonder if it's named after George Lucas. And so then the story is just about Martin Scorsese telling George Lucas that he needs to make a sci-fi movie or whatever because Darth Vader comes down and all that. Like, all those references. I was just thinking, like, it must have been so obvious to everybody around George at the time that he's this hyper-talented dude, but he's just, like, has a lack of confidence. This is kind of insecurity about everything. But he's got the magic, you know? He's got it. If he just follows the steps, and I feel connected to that because I understand that, like, actually making the content is what made it happen. Him going out there to Tunisia and being really hot and annoyed and the R2-D2 droids falling over and all that stuff, that's what makes Star Wars great. By putting that effort in there and having your vision and just being absolutely sure that's what you want. And not even if you're sure, but adamant that you want it. You know what I mean? I want it to be this way. I need this. I need this. We're going to go here and we're going to do this. And then by the end of it, you go, yeah, I think it worked. You still don't know until the audiences will pick up. But if they hadn't done all of that, if he hadn't put that investment in and put all of his blood, sweat, and tears in, none of that would have happened. And so that's why it's so insulting to me on the back end when somebody picks up the Star Wars brand and is like, oh, yeah, this is great. And they just dust it off and resell it. Because it doesn't have that, there's not that struggle. There's not that struggle to maintain relevance in the business. There's no struggle to get your career going. There's no struggle to impress Martin Scorsese and Bob Z and all these different people that are your peers. There's none of that hunger. The business is not hungry. The people in the business are not hungry to create their own material like they used to be in that era. It's now just like, how do I extract money from these fans? How do I get money from Star Wars fans? Well, give them this, you know? That's what I think is missing. I want more.
Slap a Star Wars sticker on it, even if it's shit. Lunchbox that you can buy for like a quid from a pound shop. Just put a Star Wars sticker on it.
Exactly.
Sell it.
Exactly. And that, what does that really represent? Well, underneath that, it should be this respect for somebody who put all these genre pieces together that brought all these fans together. But they don't do that.
But it became such a phenomenon.
Remember this era when people actually had fun and stuff?
It's hard to remember a time.
It's hard to remember what my dick was like when it was soft.
The world was different then. There were no cell phones or personal computers. The internet was years away. Even home video had yet to catch
on. But does any of this matter? Do you think?
I don't think so.
I don't think any of it matters. But yeah, I get it. I the only thing that I think that matters,
I guess he's trying to like state how far in like the past Star Wars was made. It's like, oh, did you know it was made before the internet? Before cell phones?
For over 1,000 generations, the internet never existed. Then Star Wars.
You know, just randomly, I remember watching an Australian documentary on computers and how they were going to predict like the computer age. It's like, wow, it was really like more than they ever imagined, isn't it? Because they always assumed that it was going to be like it was going to be a computer in every home, and it's like, wow, you really didn't even predict that, you know, we're going to have computers in our fucking pockets.
You know,
like,
they had
no idea.
I feel like the future was predicted a million times, and it's just like it's never 100% accurate, you know. But like cell phones, come on, Star Trek had that, you know, the idea to an extent.
And it's the same with their little pads. But then there's a difference between having an idea, but then and also like trying to realistically predict where like the society technology is going.
Well, like, go on. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Was it like I was saying on the documentary, they didn't have any idea that we were going to have computers in our pockets. They just assume the best it could go was it's going to be amazing where we're going to have a computer in every home, and it's going to be just like this, because you know at the moment a computer is as big as a a room, but then it's going to be as big as a table.
Right.
And then he started saying that we're going to do everything on the computer. We're going to do our banking online. We're going to do this, that, and the other. It's like, yeah, I mean, you're there, but it's really even more amazing than what you predicted. And I think his prediction was for like 2015 or something, but it was still quite off. I mean, if you want to go to like a lot of the predictions, like Back to the Future was also pretty off as well.
Well, I was going to say that, I was going to mention that Zemeckis said that he dislikes futuristic stuff because it's just the director's opinion. It's just whatever you think it's going to be, and then it's never accurate. So what he was saying was that his least favorite part of Back to the Future was creating the future, because he thought that everybody assumed that the future would be a negative place and all dark and stuff, but that's not the tone of Back to the Future. So
he turned the future into a series.
He just wanted it to be a series of gags, which I really like. And then he made the past negative, like the 1980s of Biff's alternative world or whatever. Mm-hmm. But the idea of the future being anything more to Bob than a series of gags, I think was the thing that he didn't, you know, he had no interest in accurately speculating on what the future would look like, because, you know, the leaps in society are going to be random as fuck. You know what I mean? There's going to be have you ever seen any movie where they try to show what music is like in the future and it's just not even musically interesting?
Or even fashion, like what people are going to be wearing.
Exactly.
And it's always like the most stupidest and outrageous things.
You gotta pull your pockets out. All the kids wear their pockets out, Marty. So yeah,
like,
no,
even,
nobody's
like
gonna
Star
wear
Trek
that.
Or The Orville have. I think The Orville's probably done it a bit better, but Star Trek specifically has struggled really hard for like trying to come up with what people will wear like off the clock, like their casual clothes.
Oh yeah, it's just like
because I think it becomes
from
a lack of understanding of like why people wear stuff and like why fashion changes, because I think there would definitely be a fashion change, but at the exact same time I think the more things change there is a certain element which does stay the same, like the reason why we like certain clothes, for example.
That's why I like retrofuturism. Rutger Hauer in one of his interviews was saying that Ridley Scott, one of the things that he was so impressed by both Blade Runner was that Ridley Scott told him that the future is not new, the future is old. And I like that idea. I like the idea that the future is probably going to be like a recursive thing, like fanny packs will come back into effect, all this stuff from the 80s, like synthwave and all that. It was cheesy in the 90s, nobody wanted that Hall and Oates sound, but now synthwave is ubiquitous. People that never grew up in that era love the aesthetics of it. And then there's the 90s aesthetics of vaporwave with all the Windows 95 shit. Who knows what the next era is going to be like, because the people that come after us are going to pick up on what we put down. I remember when I was growing up, I was super invested into late 80s stuff or 90s cartoons or whatever, because I was born in 91. So the stuff that immediately came before felt like where I needed to be at. Like, oh, I need to know all this stuff. So it's interesting to me that when I'm thinking about my futuristic stuff, I'm not even thinking about what people are wearing or whatever like that. Like, I think that the first thing to go is, oh, everybody will be wearing biotech jumpsuits or something like that, to try and dissociate people from the sociological role playing that happens with costuming. Like, people wear certain costumes for certain venues, you know? Like, if anybody that goes to any of these music festivals or any of these shows, you know that girls at raves will wear different outfits than they wear at their job, you know? It's more about the venue than it is about the time period when it comes to style. It's more about what group you're a part of. And style is kind of a out-of-place thing. Like, if somebody wanted to bring back mod style from the 1960s and they were rich and famous and there was a bunch of, you know, people that were doing it, it probably would come back. So I don't know what the future would look like, except a reverb, a echo, and a regeneration of the past. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if tri-corner hats came back at some point, just because, like, I have no idea why it would be, but, like, you know what I mean? That I think that the future is probably going to be a combination of past elements and current elements with future technology. So what I would do is I would present a retro-futuristic angle to begin with. Like, when we go back and watch old science fiction material or the future, the biggest problem that I think people have is, like, screens. Like, we have a cathode ray display in Total Recall. because how else are you going to show off a screen? Are you going to do a green screen replacement? They didn't have flat screens then. So that's going to date it. And like all the physical buttons compared to touch panels, that's going to date it. But when you think about it, why wouldn't touch screens and holographic displays be dated 20 years from now when we have something else? When we have like tactile, you know, when you can touch holograms in the air, all these touchscreen shows are going to be really outdated, you know? And because we can't predict what's physically going to be possible because we think that it's science fiction, it creates a barrier between our imagination of what the future is going to look like and realistically creating it. That's why I think that unbelievably, the Avatar movie from 2008 has really good aesthetics in it. It really feels like a real environment. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's more important to make something feel like it's a real system than it is to be futuristic, if that makes any sense. It's more important for things to look like they function than to look like they function in the future, right? Even though they have like M60 guns or whatever, it's like the fact that everything fits together aesthetically, just like Star Wars, everything's kind of kloogied together, or Back to the Future, even though it has like a off-the-wall aesthetic, the time machine looks specifically built for its purpose at the time it was made. And that, I think, is much more successful than trying to accurately capture what the future looks like. Because when people do that, when people think of generic future, I think they think of Mass Effect. Everything is sleek. Everything is hyper cool.
Well, Mass Effect isn't exactly, I would say, sleek. It's a mix of like Star Trek and Star Wars, where it's kind of has these sleeker elements, but also a little bit of those grungier parts at the exact same time. Like the Normandy SR2, I think, is a good example of this.
Sorry, I think that it's all I can think of when I think of Mass Effect is slick, like this smooth.
Mm.
And I know that there's different races that have different technology, but when I think about the humans, everything is like, I also call that kind of like a Japanese-ish aesthetic, where everything is like smooth lines with slight, like there might be a gap between whatever the plastic plates are, you know what I mean? Mm. But everything fits together perfectly in Mass Effect. There's no like glued on bits and things, and you know, bits and bobs and light up stuff that's kind of out of place. It's all purpose built. That's kind of what I see reflected in the Star Trek Picard show, which rips it off. It's like everything's supposed to be slick and dark or whatever, but that's not their aesthetic, you know? It's important that you establish what the aesthetic of the universe is and how the people interact with it, because there's a uniformity to whatever reality that you're going to be in if it's the future. And you know, you can be more generic like The Expanse, but where you feel like there's actually a tactile nature to it, or you can make it more ridiculous and distant and aesthetically pleasing to look at, like Hitchhiker's Guide. But you have to define a consistency to it, or else you're going to lose people. That's, I think it's like I was saying, I think consistency is more important than prescience when it comes to sci-fi.
The space race was over.
That's one small step for man.
Americans felt deeply mired in the present. It was a time of economic inflation and rising oil prices.
That whole Carter thing.
And the nation had grown cynical about its heroes and its leaders.
Well, I'm not a crook.
In our country, Watergate tore us apart. And then we had the Vietnam War on top of that, which was dividing the nation like nothing else had.
It feels like we're in a time loop, doesn't it? Like Nixon, the Trumpian kind of thing, everybody being cynical. You know, we need another one of these. We need another Star Wars, man. We need a Noble Bright series.
We need a hero. That's what we need.
I need a hero. Hello, Tuscan Productions.
Of great storm and violence in our history.
On the big screen, Hollywood's view was equally grim. The films
when did
the
Jaws
came
out? Come out.
Were grim.
No clue, actually. It came out in 1975.
Interesting. Okay. The blockbuster was invented in this era, I guess. I'm trying to contextualize what he's talking about here. Like, was it actually all depressing stuff? Not sure about that.
Gritty and often downbeat, a reflection of America's social and political upheaval. Instead of old-fashioned heroes, the screen was dominated by hard-nosed anti-heroes.
See, I don't believe that. I don't think that I believe that at all, because if I'm looking at 1978 highest grossing films, it's like Superman, Grease, Animal House, Every Which Way But Loose. It really seems like people were looking for that. Deer Hunter was number 10. That, you know what I mean? Like a third of the money that Superman was making at the box office. So I'm not sure that I don't even think that the post-Vietnam era stuff had hit yet. I think this was basically the burnout of the 60s, right? Like everybody that had been doing LSD and stuff, and this was becoming the Easy Rider era, which was much more, I don't know. I wasn't there. I can't contextualize it very much, but it felt like the end of the LSD era of the 60s turned into the groovy disco era of the 70s. And things got more urbane. I'm not sure if Star Wars was the one that broke us out of the depression of the 70s. I'm just not... You know what I mean?
I think I know, yeah.
Well, I'm not sure either. I need to go back and watch some of these. There's so many 70s films that I haven't seen. Yeah, I mean, like Midnight Express, I haven't watched, but I should. Anyway, we'll talk about this. We can do that later.
In the late 60s, the Warners, the Zanucks, all the people that started the studios in the first place were retiring, and they were selling the studios to corporations. They were beverage companies and all kinds of other, they were in other businesses. They didn't know at all how to run a movie studio. All they know is,
oh, by the way, because of this, like what he's saying here, we should definitely do an episode where we cover that transition between the Hollywood being the old studio heads, like the Samuel Goldman types, to the Robert Evans, young, the Brat Pack era, and also the corporate era. Because there's a great, I'll collect the information, but in this era, when all of these development companies bought these corporations that owned the film studios, they were selling off a lot of the backlot land. And so Hollywood actually shrunk in this time substantially, because the people that were in charge of production, they didn't know much about production. It's the same. It's like almost the same as it is today, where people are buying up brands. They used to buy up the companies that owned the brands. So like Bob Iger back in the day would be some sort of like, you know, some sort of banker that would buy one of these companies like Canon or whatever it was. So I totally get what he's talking about here.
The only problem is I wouldn't know anything to add to this discussion, because I don't know anything about the history specifically.
In the future, when we're planning out the episodes, I'll make sure that we do our homework first. That'll be fun, so we can know what we're talking about instead of just relying on the old favorites that we know.
See this, then you make that. So they started marketing pictures and studying the demographics and all these kinds of things, and they realized that there was a market for films made by young people for young people, because the young person was becoming a bigger part of their market.
The studio system that lasted for decades had now collapsed, and Hollywood executives, desperate to connect with younger audiences, turned to film schools to find the next generation of movie makers.
God damn, I wish they did that again.
It was in this atmosphere of change that gifted young directors like Francis Ford Coppola, Brian De Palma, Martin Scorsese, and Steven Spielberg
were all doing coke.
Sensibility to the screen.
It was a state of confusion, and a lot of filmmakers got to make projects that they ordinarily wouldn't have gotten to make. And I got caught right in the middle of it.
George was the kind of maverick from Northern California, an independent filmmaker who was always extremely proud that he had very few attachments to Hollywood.
Sounds like me.
Born in Modesto, California.
George was basically like hanging. He was like Francis Ford Coppola's like buddy. So he was doing all these behind the scenes stuff, and that's why he would be carrying around those Bolexes or whatever film cameras he was using. He would do a lot of stuff that was supplementary while trying to figure out what he wanted to do after THX, because those were his college projects, which is why it's so funny that Star Wars, like the biggest product came from the guy that was kind of low on the corporate totem pole at the time, which is why I love George so much, because it seems like he came out of nowhere, you know? Came out of the B team almost. While Spielberg was the youngest man to direct a television episode and sneaking on sets, and Francis Ford Coppola was trying to get people to fund his company, George was still trying to figure out what he wanted to do with his career and ended up being the guy that leapfrogged over all of them.
Lucas grew up reading adventure stories and watching movie serials on television.
Classic.
But it wasn't until college that his own dreams of filmmaking began to surface. In 1963, he left Modesto to attend film classes at the University of Southern California.
I was teaching at USC, and George was in one of the seminars. We talked
about. Isn't
that
a great thing? Irvin Kershner's teaching.
Filmmaking.
Irving is teaching people how to do stuff, and George is one of his students. So then when George turned around to do Empire Strikes Back, he's like, I'm going to call up my old teacher. He knows what he's doing. I'm going to call him a teacher. I love it. And it's like this guy, and what's great about it is that Empire Strikes Back, I think, is one of the two of Irving's best movies. So it's just, I love how real that is. I love how it's like these big millions of dollars that are being thrown around is not really what's as important as getting your old teacher to teach you how to do stuff, you know, and how to how you want this film to be made, coming out of your background. I just love that. That's the personal touch that I really enjoy about film, is that you can make deals with people that are your friends and not nepotistically, but people that you know that are very talented people. You can give them a job, and that job is to create art. And there's not really another thing that's like that other than like video games or music. That's the thing that I love about art, is that you can bring together people that you know that are talented to create a greater piece of work that lives on after you are gone, basically, after you're dead or you're done. That's why I love this story so much, because it absolutely served a purpose that helped everybody that was involved.
From the beginning, George had a unique vision.
George was a guy that thought out of the box, as you can certainly see by his student film THX 1138. And he shot a film that was 20 minutes long. It was supposed to be 5 minutes. But he got a great deal of recognition and opened the eyes of the professors that kids could do something out of the box, beyond what the restrictions were.
There's a pause real quick. There's an old tale where one of George's teachers, when they were at USC and Milius was there, everybody was supposed to do a film and they were going to play all the films together. And George finished his film quicker than the other ones and he wanted to show it. And the teacher was like, no, you can't do that. And apparently Milius hit the teacher and was like, you're really not gonna let this guy shoot his film? He did it before everybody else. You gotta let him do it. Blah, 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 blah. And so then they let him do it. And I love that, because Milius is the guy that did Conan the Barbarian. He's the one that wrote Apocalypse Now. So you have this like timid George, who you can see in his work writes characters that are like that, kind of like Luke Skywalker. And you compare that to someone like Milius, who writes Jeremiah Johnson, these really burly guys that push people out of the way because they need to get their stuff done. So much of an artist is in the art, which is why I'm against the death of the author thing. The death of the author thing is critics trying to take ownership away from an author and take away their experience that led to the art being created, because it's all in the work. Your life is put into the work. So I just wanted to say that story because it's so funny that George was standing there and his teacher gets slapped by his friend for not letting him play his movie, which is great.
Lucas won acclaim for his technical skills and imagination as a storyteller. His interest in mythology and philosophy gave his work an added dimension.
George's style was fantastic.
Incredible.
I don't care what he was doing, it just looked more personal than some of the other work.
After graduating from USC, Lucas joined his friend Francis Ford Coppola in San Francisco, where in 1969, Coppola founded American Zoetrope, an independent film company.
Hell yeah.
I came up with no intention of actually becoming successful, but I did have a very strong feeling about being able to be in control of my work and not having people tamper with it.
I don't want to be mean or anything, but I imagine if George Lucas like shaved his beard, it would just like it, like his neck, how fat his neck has become, it would just look like a giant two.
He'd look like Boss Nass.
I don't want to be, I really don't want to be mean, but
Misa give you sa una star.
It just kind of distracts me every time I look at George. Like I'm trying to not be as mean as possible.
Mean Shiney.
Lucas directed THX 1138, a theatrical feature based on his student film. But when Warner Brothers executives saw the finished product, they demanded Coppola return the $300,000 the studio had advanced to develop THX and
give
other
us
projects.
The money back.
The fledgling company imploded, and Lucas had to find work elsewhere.
Can you imagine? How bad George felt when his fucking movie tanked American Zoetrope, his friend's company? That would suck so much. That would totally take away your confidence.
I don't understand how the hell they can demand the money back when they've already made the film. Like, how can you do that?
That's legal? There's some shit. Yeah, I mean, it depends. It really depends. There's so many things that are like yeah, the unions would have something to say about that, if you get what I'm saying.
Into his own hands and start his own company, Lucasfilm Limited. For his first project under this new banner, Lucas chose American Graffiti, an affectionate look at teenage cruising in the early 1960s.
I'm a ready kid. Well, get bent, turkey.
They say right what you know.
Produced by Universal Studios, it was loosely based on his own experiences as a car enthusiast growing up in Modesto.
I had gone from being extremely experimental and hard-edged, and then really taking up a challenge that Francis gave me. I bet you can't do just a silly comedy.
Isn't that great?
You know, kind of warm and fuzzy comedy. So,
that's
okay,
like what I was saying earlier, is that the challenge. He did an entire movie based on Francis Ford Coppola challenging him. And like that's what got his career back on track. That's the kind of thing that is missing from the later era of his life, when it's like, hey, George, you should go and do this. It's like, no, I'm a 60-year-old man. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do whatever I want, even if it's inadvisable. I think that's an important understanding your audience and having feedback from your peers is really important as a filmmaker. And once you reach a certain level of respect, people are just like, I have no idea what you're doing. You know, who knows if it's going to work. A lot of Orson Welles' later stuff is like that. It's like, I don't know what to make of this, but good luck in comparison to we got to make something that's going to hit. We got to hit. Same thing happens with musicians.
The film was shot in just 28 days for under $1 million. Co-producing
is another
awesome USC alumnus, Gary Kurtz.
Toward the end of the post-production,
it's like even less than The Room.
28 days, like just a month of filming is, I mean, it's not 4 weeks. That's really impressive. That is really impressive. I got to admit. 4 weeks of filming anything and you get an entire 90-minute movie out of it, that's well done.
Well, I was even just thinking of the Room. That cost like $6 million.
Adjusted for inflation. This is 1970 something, so it's much more than that.
Oh yeah, I wasn't thinking of that.
Actually, on American Graffiti, we organized a screening at the North Point Cinema in San Francisco, and we felt the reaction to the film was quite positive. But Ned Tennant from Universal was very upset. He said, "You shouldn't be showing it to an audience at this stage." And we
what's
were
his
totally
name?
Flabbergasted.
Ned Tennant, like Biff Tannen. Isn't that funny?
Film they didn't understand, and they meddled with it after it was all finished. Same thing with my second film. The corporate entity came in and jerry-rigged with it, cut 5 minutes out.
But even before the release of American Graffiti, George Lucas's imagination was...
George Lucas really stuck onto the fact that they cut like 5 minutes out of A New Hope.
He's so fucking... I mean, he knows. Like, I would... If I spent all this time working on a project and then they just decided to just fuck with it right at the last minute, I'd be so mad. I totally understand. I understand I understand Milius going to an executive with a Colt 1911 in his hand and putting it on the table. You know what I mean? Like, I understand that shit. Like,
wait, what?
There's an old apocryphal story where I think where we got to watch Milius and then you'll understand it. John Milius, I'm pretty sure, threatened some executive or something with a gun or something like that, because of the changes that they were making. Like, there's stuff like that really can tick you off. You know what I mean? Especially if it's something like Blade Runner, which I've been doing a lot of research on, where in 2049, Hampton Fancher wrote this script. It obviously was important to him. He's an old man now. He wants to get his legacy out there. He wanted to cover stuff that was torn out of his original script from the first one. And then they changed the ending without him giving his say on what the ending is going to be like. It's like, well, you just changed all of the work that I did into something that isn't what I wanted it to be. That I would get very passionate about that. So I can understand why people get upset about permanent changes to films that are meant to just be meant to be a different way, because everybody in Hollywood, the unfortunate thing is that everybody involved in the process wants to put their fingers on it. They want their input. And so there are a lot of producers that decide to get creative, even though it's not their job, even though they're supposed to just be there to work as sort of an editor or to understand the marketing, be a money person, that kind of thing. And they're like, no, I want to get creative and alter this work that somebody else does because I have the ability to flex on them like that. And that's so I can understand why Lucas, who only cares about the creative process, really, and doesn't necessarily care about the outcome other than I hope that it makes its money back so I can keep making films. I think that that is more important to him. I think that the creative aspect, especially for any kind of filmmaker that wants to make something and have it a certain way, it's got to be about creativity and not about power or money or whatever. And so being upset about somebody else taking that creativity away from you, what's worse than that from an artistic perspective? That's the whole point you're there. That's the whole reason. Anyway.
It's pointed at the stars.
All during this time,
the designs of the X-Wings are so beautiful.
To do a Flash Gordon, kind of 1930s space opera.
Absolutely.
And he started working on that in earnest.
And people said, of all things to pick, why in the world would you do that? I said, well, you know, it's fun to make films for young people. It's a chance to sort of make an impression on them. I want to do this.
With his galactic fairy tale, Lucas hoped to reinvent a classic genre.
Among his Isn't that interesting? Was that a robot or was that a person? Educator Joseph
Campbell.
It looks like a robot, yeah. Anyway.
Among his influences.
Oh, it was fine. It was the C-3PO in the desert. I was like, oh, it looks
like that. Oh, right, like the early concept art.
It makes me think like maybe J.J. Abrams looked at that and was like, oh, that's Finn.
No, that's definitely early concept art for C-3PO. I remember the nose is pretty distinct on some of the earlier concept art.
Yeah, it looks like the Metropolis robot.
Lucas hoped to reinvent a classic genre. Among his influences were the writings of scholar and educator Joseph Campbell, in which he explored the origins of myth and world religions.
That's another thing that we should check out.
Of Star Wars,
we should check out, probably not, we should probably record it, because I don't know if it'll tag it, but Power of Myth with Joseph Campbell. Super helpful. Any writer that wants to improve their cycle of getting from the beginning to the end of a story should look up Monomyth and should know about the Power of Myth from Joseph Campbell, because he was so very clear about the meta of storytelling and what is a hero and what is a villain and what is the village and all the symbology and the Jungian aspect of stuff, you know, the stuff that Jordan Peterson talks about. It's variables that you plug into your story. So if you understand the myths on a macro scale, then you'll be able to get into the micro scale and input whatever it is that you want specifically. It's like, because you know what your archetype is. It's like, oh, I'm writing this archetype, so it's probably going to be like this. And if you want to add twists to that, you can. But knowing the archetype will allow you to develop a complex character based on it, because these archetypes are inherent to our humanity, is what Campbell's argument is. And so knowing that allows you to be more empowered as a writer.
was heavily interested in Joseph Campbell. What Joseph Campbell was interested in was to see the connections between myths, the myths of different cultures, to try to find out what were the threads that tied all these very disparate cultures together.
I did research to try to distill everything down into motifs that would be universal. I attribute most of the success to the psychological underpinnings, which had been around for thousands of years, and people still react the same way
based
to the stories as
super
they always
based
did.
George is
that's why Star Wars works.
And when he sets out to do his work, he starts reporting from the best sources he can gather. He brought Campbell into the process of looking at his work on Star Wars and saying, is this right? Am I getting it down? Is this the right emphasis? Is this the right character? Joseph Campbell said to me, the best student he ever had was George Lucas.
Like such epics as The Odyssey, Beowulf, and The Legend of King Arthur, Star Wars drew from a shared pool of mythic archetypes.
You have the youth who's on the adventure that you can identify with. You have the swashbuckler, and you have the damsel. She may not sort of have the reactions that are conventional. However, she is in distress.
I like how, like, and I'm turning 30. I identify more with Han Solo's character, like, weathered a little bit. And, like, when I think back to 10 years ago, I identify more with Luke Skywalker because he's, like, optimistic and wants to save the world and all these things. And Han Solo, at 30, I'm just like, yeah, what about my money? I need a, me and Chewie over here gotta buy a house somewhere. Like, it's more
gotta pay your taxes.
Gotta buy
some fuel.
Yeah. The IRS is coming after me, and they're run by Jabba the Hutt. it's so funny because it's mythic. It's about the stages of life that you get through. So I'm sure when I'm an old man, I'll be like, hello everyone, Obi-Wan Glib Facsimile. So now that's a name I've not heard in a.
Oh, of shit. Course I know him. He's me.
Of course I know him. He's a stupid character I invented.
Old man who you go and you find him and you have the funnier characters. I mean, it really adheres strictly to that form.
It's the traditional ritualistic coming of age story. And when I went into the mythological side of what I wanted to do, that's a key factor with heroes.
By the summer of 1973, George Lucas had created a treatment that he felt was ready to shop around. Whether anyone would be interested, that was another story.
I'd love to read that. The Jedi Bendu treatment. I wonder how many pages it is.
No fucking clue.
Because the treatment isn't the same thing as the script. It's just a description of what's happening in it.
The most successful science fiction film at that point was 2001. And successful then was that it made about $24 million or something like that. Most hit science fiction films would make about $16 million, which was the Planet of the Apes films and that sort of thing.
You know, but what's funny is that George
would make under $10 million.
George is talking about art and that kind of thing, but he's obviously aware of the money. I think it's kind of a little bit of a betrayal of his inner consciousness that he does care about success. I think he really does care about making as a widespread a film for as many people as possible. I really think that he's definitely an artist, but he's also got a little bit of that producer brain. Because he knows, it's like, oh yeah, science fiction films, they usually make 16, 24, here's what I can expect. He probably had that in the back of his mind, but the insecure part of him is like, I don't want to be presumptive. I don't want to, you know what I mean? Who knows? I don't want to be like that. That's his art and craft right there. Selling this idea.
Yeah, I can certainly understand what you're getting out there. Yeah,
because I know that I'm super about the art, but also I'm like, yeah, I want to make fucking $1 billion movie, man. I want to.
Like, I'm awesome about like the creativity of my videos, but those subs.
Exactly. Kinda want them. You still think about it. You're still like, oh man, I wish you know a million people cared about what I do or whatever it is. But if you focus on that and you get lost in it, you'll lose what you should be focusing on. But it's good to know that kind of stuff. It's good to know what the audience is for a product so that you don't get yourself disappointed when you realize that, oh, I made a shitty horror cheap movie. Only so many people are going to watch it because these are the audience for that. Just make it for the audience, you know? And with kids, it's almost limitless. If you make something for kids, it's like, who knows how really successful it's going to be. Star Wars is an example of that.
$1 million. I mean, there's no reason to think that it would do any different.
Star Wars was more space fantasy than science fiction. but its galactic setting made it a tough sell in 1973.
When I was pitching the film, all I had was like a 14-page story treatment. It was very vague, said it's kind of a 1930s action-adventure Saturday afternoon serial based on the kind of Flash Gordon, Buck Rogers kind of comic
book. I know like what it's like Saturday serial means, but it just makes you think of actual serial.
Yeah, is that you wake up in the morning, eat cereal, yeah, then watch cartoons. Yeah, that's what I think about. But it's funny because it's totally right. If you're making a Buck Rogers, if you're selling Flash Gordon in 1973, people are like, "What? That's a 40-year-old thing. What do you mean, Star Wars? What do you mean by that?"
And that's about all they knew about it.
In the 70s, science fiction seemed to be all about apocalyptic societies and death and destruction. Not very inspiring, so we were fighting an uphill battle with the science fiction project.
George Lucas brought Star Wars to Universal and United Artists. Both studios passed on the project, but the ambitious young filmmaker was secretly relieved. The last thing he wanted was to hand his dream project to the wrong people.
He didn't care for the studio system. He used it because there was no other way of doing what he needed to do.
That's basically everybody.
Undaunted, Lucas presented Star Wars to Alan Ladd Jr., the new head of creative affairs at 20th Century Fox.
Alan Ladd Sr. was a very successful noir actor, and that's where Alan Ladd Jr. came out of. And Alan Ladd Jr. is one of my favorite producers and executives of the time period, because without him, you wouldn't have Star Wars, you wouldn't have Blade Runner, you wouldn't have a lot of really, really interesting concepts and movies. And I feel like people like him don't really get enough credit. Like the fact that The Driver exists, Alien, you know what I mean? Like all these, you know, Wizards, the animated movie. Like, this dude really understood what films should be, what you should be a part of. You know what I mean? I think that it's we need people in that position to green light and have somebody who has vision by looking at a director and a writer and a movie pitch and being able to go, yes, that is creative, that's interesting, and that'll sell. And I think that I should be the one to push it. And take a risk, because these guys are going to be the ones that are going to really feel the pain if things go wrong. I mean, he's the one that got fired for making Star Wars, even though it became a huge hit, because after the people that didn't believe in Star Wars saw how successful it was, they got pissed off that the deal was that the sequel rights went to George. So George is finagling about the financials, and the fact that nobody believed in it got them really pissed off after the fact. And that's what got Alan Ladd Jr. fired from Fox, as far as I know. So it's interesting how many people you have to go through to get a film made, to believe in you, and how you have to play to different audiences. You have to play to the producer audience. You have to play to the kids that are actually in the audience. You have to find the right production people to help you do it. You have to be a master of all these little pieces. And George was very, very clever in a way that he doesn't talk about the rights situation and the legal aspects of everything that he was doing. Because he really wanted to create an alternative Hollywood in Northern California. And he's been fighting the unions and fighting the film business in general ever since then. So, you know, I just want to give credit to Alan Ladd Jr. for green lighting stuff like Moonstruck and Thelma and Louise and all these movies that eventually became hits, like Police Academy and Chariots of Fire. Like, this, you need a guy on your team that works for the studio, understands the budgets, but also believes in people.
Sir, was able to recognize potential in the filmmaker, if not necessarily the film.
We had a meeting. And George said, well, I've been thinking about this thing called Star Wars, and told me about it. I said, that sounds terrific. I mean, the technology part of the whole thing was completely over my head, but I just believed in him and his genius. I sort of recognized off of American Graffiti that he really was a genius, so I just flew with it.
He understood what talent was. He respected talent. And he was able to say, I think this guy's talented. I think we're going to invest in him. So Alan Ladd Jr. invested in me. He did not invest in the movie, and it paid off.
Love it.
In 1973, Ladd's investment in George Lucas proved justified. American Graffiti was finally released to rave reviews and became the third highest grossing picture of the year.
You want to know something funny about that too? More than 100 million. Mm-hmm. That without American Graffiti, I don't think that Martin Scorsese would be scoring his films the way that he does, because American Graffiti was one of the first films to use music of the era that was a part of, like rock music instead of a score. And what Scorsese did later was he would take eight track, right? What am I talking about? The pre-tape stuff that they used to have in cars. Richard in the audience probably knows. But the thing is, he would record all these different songs that he would hear that he would like that would give him a vision. Just like how you and I were talking about how we listen to music and we meditate on an idea, and then the story comes through the rhythm of the music and it flows through us, that kind of thing. Scorsese has like thousands of records stored up in his library. And what he'll do is he'll pull from those every time that he has a scene. He goes, oh, that scene reminds me of that one time I listened to this song. And that's how you get, you know, those amazing moments where he's chopping up music and like a DJ and throwing them into the thing. I think that comes from American Graffiti, because if you look at the soundtrack for it, it's just a playlist of all these songs that they listened to in the 50s and the early 60s when they were kids.
$1 billion worldwide.
American Graffiti showed a very human sense heart that George has always had, by the way. And I think that surprised a lot of people.
With a preliminary deal for Star Wars in place, Lucas began writing his screenplay in 1974. It proved more ambitious than he had first imagined. The filmmaker was able to distill his idea down to its essence, an epic battle between a heroic rebel alliance and an evil galactic empire. The chief villain, Darth Vader, was there practically from the start. But it took time to come up with Star Wars' three main heroes: a plucky young princess named Leia Organa, the fearless Corellian smuggler.
Super chat by Black Mercury for $5. Where can you watch American Graffiti?
If you go on to, there's a website called justwatch.com. You can search for any film and it'll give you a list of the services where they have it. I personally, what I like to do is I have right now for streaming, it's on Cinemax, DirecTV, and the channel on Prime HD, but you can rent it on YouTube, Google Play, Amazon, all those things. I personally, what I like to do is I like to get Netflix Blu-rays, you know, and then maybe, you know, you can rip those, you know, save them for later. I mean, I'm not saying I do that, you know. I'm not saying, is that the script over there?
Also, and very quickly, sorry I missed this. Alex Heller for $2, Hollywood really does need to fall.
Hollywood, I think that the idea of like the congealed Hollywood system as it is now is just like a cancer node, you know what I mean? It's just like sitting there, and it's like all just, you like do something, be something, but it's not. It's just gonna sit there sucking on old stuff, you know? So Hollywood needs to be revamped, and they need to redo the rules, and I don't know how that's gonna happen. I don't know how we're gonna get away, because things are too expensive. The unions have too many rules. The studios are too stingy. They're too afraid. Movies are too expensive to be made. Who are you making them for? They're not original. I don't know what it's going to take. Genuinely don't know. I don't know if it's going to be technology. I don't know if it's going to be the audience shifting its perceptions of film. I don't know if it's going to be streaming services and YouTube. But it's not viable right now. It's on a downward slope right now, especially because of COVID. We'll see what happens when they come back. But I don't think that the paradigm is going to stay the same for a long time. I think it's going to change in the next 10 years substantially. And it'll be better. It'll be better in some way.
Known as Han Solo. And most important, an idealistic farm boy whose original name was Luke Starkiller. Over the course of his adventure, Luke trains to become a Jedi Knight, deriving his power from a mystical energy known as the Force. But along the way, the script went through radical changes. At one point, Luke was a 60-year-old general, and Han Solo had green skin and gills.
That probably became
Even
Yoda.
The concept of the Force had yet to be fully realized.
And the general probably became
Instead, there was the Kyber crystal.
or something.
Still, a sort of galactic holy grail.
The concept of the Force was an important one in the story, and the difficulty is trying to create a religious spiritual concept that works in a very simple way without heavy exposition or without it seeming to pull down the story.
It got to be a very fast
That's kind of the
script,
key of everything, isn't 200 it?
200 pages.
Making it mm-hmm. simple and making something simple, universal, and applicable to the story without having to spend so much time on it. That's the film thing, is being concise, because you only have so many pages, really, to discuss anything. I mean, you can fill up a page with action text to describe something, but it's not going to help actually describe something to the audience. You need to make a concept that's basic and show it visually. Show in or have a dialogue piece that is either not too expository in that they're saying, before the era of the age of the wanderer, your father and 20,000 years ago, like all that stuff. You need it to be concise, you know? For over a thousand generations, the Jedi were the guardians of peace and justice in the galaxy. Then that changed when the Empire showed up. It's like, okay, well, now we know. That's it. The Force, oh, it's an energy field. It encompasses all living things. Got it. Let's keep moving. That's filmmaking. If you dwell on that for too long, trying to explain it, it's going to ruin it.
And the story had gotten away from me. So the only way I could cope with it was to say, I'll take the first third, the first act, and I'll make that into a movie. But I'd written all this other stuff. I'd spent a year writing this story. And I said, well, I'm not going to just throw away two-thirds of my year and say, this is all I can afford at this point. This is the only amount of money I'm going to get is to do this one movie. So I put it on the shelf, and I said, by hook or by crook, I will finish this movie.
But Star Wars wouldn't be cheap. To get the Fox board of directors to approve the necessary budget, Lucas needed something dramatic. He hired Ralph McQuarrie, a conceptual design artist who had worked for Boeing.
I'd seen some of his paintings, and I thought he was really brilliant. I had said, look, I want you to do some paintings of these scenes that I've done so that the studio can get a picture of what it is I'm talking about. When
Super
I turned
important.
In the script, I had about mm-hmm. five or six drawings.
And his art is what defines Star Wars so well. Like his clean lines and that similar style to what Lucas made with American Graffiti with the one-point perspective. That's really what defined the look of Star Wars. And in addition to Joe Johnston after that.
Or even Ryan Church's contributions as well. I really love a lot of the concept artist work, and I do like it when people can sort of like alter the concept artist's work so that they really get at what they like to refine the designs. Because like obviously, I really do think the final design for Vader is much better than this early concept work, and it's the fact that. I would say that Ralph McQuarrie's work is like an incredible foundation for these designs, and obviously they wouldn't have been able to happen without him, but I think I definitely prefer the final iterations.
Yeah, I just think that if without it, there wouldn't be an aesthetic to mm-hmm. even adjust, you know.
But you can even see like the very basic foundations of the Rebel Blockade Runner corridor here. With the little packs on the wall and the pillars.
Exactly. And then they just change the color because the lighting it's orangey instead of white. Mm-hmm. The contrast.
Well, and the actual lights in the scenes, this big panel here, that's not a light in this shot. It's just a part of the roof.
Yeah. I'm not a huge fan of Ryan Church's stuff, but it is closest to something that's Star Wars-y in comparison to other people that have tried to pick up the same thing.
I think I'm not a big fan of all of his work, but like for example, I really don't like his work on Star Trek.
Oh, like, really?
It's Ryan Church's work on Star Trek, like 2009. Really hate that. Like his influences on how they redesigned the Enterprise.
I like his regular
looks.
I like his just like whatever he wants to make stuff, because it's obviously he likes mm-hmm. the more organic stuff, and Star Wars and Trek are not that organic swooping lines, you know. Transformers is more his thing, you know.
Well, even just looking at a few of his concept artwork now, I really like a lot of his environmental designs, Obviously, some of it, like the one where like the Venator's crashing down on Coruscant, doesn't really look that Star Warsy, but again, it's still like the same basic idea. Like, or even his designs of the AT-ATs. That's the foundation of what would eventually become the AT-ATE, which we know from like Star Wars Episode 2.
Yeah, I hear you on that. Yeah, I just think if he was to design a civilization that was more into organic design and more about platforms and swooping lines, sharpness, glowing stuff, a little bit away from Star Wars, a little bit more towards John Connor, not John Connor, what is it? John Carter of Mars, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, we are well.
So, all right. Say this is what it's going to look like.
Do you want to go until the end of this segment and then we can call it a stream?
Yeah, we can. I didn't even realize we've been going for two and a half hours already.
Okay.
For a big spectrum.
How long's this segment?
I don't know.
Spectacular visual, and it didn't come across in the script. So I tried to give it scale, juxtaposing the tiny little figures with the great spectacular backgrounds. George would say, don't worry about how we're going to do it. We just want to see an impression of what the scenes would look like on the screen.
Basic shapes. That's what makes it so good, I think. Basic shapes and like nice characters.
Macquarie's artwork won over the Fox Board of Directors, who soon approved a budget of just over $8 million. With only the first part of his Star Wars saga being made, Lucas also needed to think about the future. But his prior dealings with major studios had taught him to be cautious.
When I made the deal for Star Wars, originally I made the deal before American Graffiti didn't even come out. Because Alan Ladd had seen the film American Graffiti, he said, I'll make a deal. But he made a very, you know, you're going to make X number of dollars and this kind of thing. And it was a very, like, one-page memo. When it came up to doing the contract for the film, which was about a year later, I knew that what I really had to do was to protect the unwritten part, the other two parts of the script.
All of a sudden, Graffiti comes out, and it's a big, huge, smash success. So his agent came back and said, well, hey, look, this guy's made this huge, successful movie now. Don't you think we should get more than a couple $100,000 for writing, directing, and producing a movie? I said, yeah, I think you should get more.
I was very careful to say, I don't want more money. I don't want more points. I don't want anything financial, but I do want the right to make these sequels. I was working on the assumption, as every filmmaker works on, which is the film will be a disaster and that it won't be promoted and it'll just die a horrible death. And it'll be very hard to get these next two movies made.
George said, like a big slice of the merchandising. Up until that time, merchandising had been relatively unknown.
When I took over the licensing, I simply said, I'm going to be able to make t-shirts, I'm going to be able to make posters, and I'm going to be able to sell this movie, even though the studio won't. So I managed to get control of pretty much everything that was left over that the studio didn't really care about.
George was enormously farsighted, and the studio wasn't, because they didn't know that the world was changing. George did know the world was changing. I mean, he changed it.
All right. I think that's good.
Yep. 20 minutes in.
Yeah. And then we can, if we want, I think this would be fun to continue, actually, and keep talking about it.
Yeah, it definitely would be.
All right. Well, best chat. If you want to join Shiny's Discord, it's in the about info, whatever section.
It should be in the description.
Yeah. So, basically, if you guys want any feedback, that would be the best place to do it, where we can both see it. We have a channel dedicated to the thing. We definitely want feedback. Anything that you guys want us to check out or look into, we will consider everything. I don't know if we'll do everything, but we really appreciate the opportunity to hang out. And we hope you liked it. I enjoyed talking. I hope I didn't talk too much.
It's great to have this discussion. And I think you were talking fine. I was very interested in what you were talking about. I just wish I could contribute a little bit more to some of the discussions. Sometimes I didn't really have anything to add, or I was just really interested in what was going on in the video. I think we had a lot to talk about with Star Trek specifically, but with Star Wars, it was a lot of just yeah, this is good. This is interesting. Just watching the documentary.
It will. So anything that you think that you think you can contribute more to and all the stuff that we have going on, it's like, I'm excited. I'm ready to talk about whatever we want to talk about. I love talking about making films, and I specifically love talking about people that influenced what I want to do and me. So, that's, you know, whatever you want to do, Shiney, if you want to talk more about this or that, I'm game. So this is episode zero, everybody. Thank you for being here for the prototype, the beta phase. And, we love you. And, I don't know what else to add.
Well, see you in the next episode. I think cool. This is going to be a Sunday show, right?
Yeah, we want to do it on Sunday, you know, because Literature Devil does his thing Monday to Saturday. So we want to give you guys something on Sunday when I wake up or when Shiney wakes up and we're like, morning nonsense. Oh, wait, it's Sunday. So Chick-fil-A free day on the Sabbath, we will convene to talk about nerdy stuff.
Unfortunately, I don't think I'll be able to do every Sunday, and there will also be certain days where you probably have to move it to accept people like Southpaw or other guests which you want to talk on.
Absolutely.
About other subjects. Because not everyone's always available on a Sunday, obviously.
This show is a flexible show. It's going to be based on whatever we can get our hands on. So stay tuned. That's what I'll say.
And that's it.
All right. See you guys later.